מה שנתנו לי את הרשימה, אני רוצה לקבל בברכת ברוכים הבאים את כבוד הרב, ידידי וחברי, הרב יוסף מזרחי. היינו הרב מזרחי לום לום טיים. אלעד, היינו עוד together in rabbinical court, בדין, בתקוד מורנו ורבנו הרב אליהו בן חיים שליטה והרב מזרחי עושה חיל לקרב את אחינו ואחיותינו בני ישראל לבותיהם להבינו שבשמיים. כבוד הרב, ברוך הבא, כבוד גדול לנו, מקווה שכבודנו לעתים קרובות. כמובן את הרב המכובד, כבוד הרב הגאון, הרב רבי ירון, ראובן שליטה. ותשמעו כן הוא, the rabbi give me the list, I say why you put your name the last? But because I not wait for his answer, because I know his last name Anava, Anava, Oksar, Prashtoy. I don't want to make a long, you know, I speak very well Hebrew, very well Bukharian, and Afghani, and Farsi, and a little more or less English. But this rabbi speak very, very English. Now the lecture be in English. Why? Because the I would tend to say, if you go to the country of the blind people, also you close one eye. You know, and today we live in America. You come from Bukhara, from Morocco, from Israel. You must try to speak English. That's it. Special for young generation. כבוד הרבנים, בכבוד. Thank you very much, ברוכים הבאים.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you all for having us. Kvod HaRav, it opens the shul always for us. And for all the people who organize, work so hard to make the event happen. Okay, like this, good?
Yeah. Oh.
So first of all, I want to thank quickly, first of all, Borei Olam, for even making this event happen. Later on, maybe will be time, I'll share with you what was involved to get this event to happen. So Baruch Hashem, first of all, Shevach V'Hodaya L'Kadosh Baruch Hu, that he brought us here. And I feel very honored and humbled to be here, B'Chvod HaRabanim. And Katonti Mikol HaMa'asim. Sometimes I stand on a stage, I feel big. Now I feel very small. But Baruch Hashem, this is a very auspicious time, a very auspicious moment. I want to start with a few words and then go to the lecture itself. First, I want to welcome also Kvod HaRabanim, Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi, Rabbi Yaron Reuven, the Rabbi of the Beit Knesset, Nasirov. Many people were involved to make this event happen. We're not going to start mentioning names because then we're going to have a lecture of names. We're going to very quickly, I want to just wish very personally, a refuah shlema to a few people, to Shira Shoshana Batamara, ודוד בן נסריה, וחיה שרה בת מלכה, וישראל בן איסתם, and also אברהם בן רליה יקירה, ורבקה תייר בת לאוניטה. And all כלל ישראל that needs a refuah shlema, we're not going to mention names now, אז בעזרת השם, anybody who needs רפואת הנפש, רפואת הגוף, לא שומעים?
יורד.
Anybody who needs רפואה should have a רפואה שלמה, an immediate recovery. Also לעילוי נשמת דוד בן רינה בבחנוב. I believe today is the 30. 30 את היום?
Yes.
Today is the 30. Also ארי בן מרים, דניאל ג'רבוי, בן ברכה, עידן בן ויולד חיה, שלא אוהב עליית נשמה. אינני על הנשמה, עוד הנשמות, או נשמות ישראל שעוד אוהב עליית נשמה, אבל אותו כדי הבא עוד משיח, דנבי סז ויקיצו וירננו שוכני אפר, והם בתוכם. So any neshama that needs an aliyah should have an aliyah. And last but not least, a zivug for Elad ben Doris. To find a zivug agun and all the people in the crowd and Klal Israel that needs a zivug. To find their other half, the right zivug, and stand on the Torah for Pama Asim Tovim. And a general beracha for all Klal Israel. That all your wishes should be fulfilled in the best way possible. Whether it's refuah, yirat shamayim, ahavat Hashem, healthy kids, chatona, everything that you wish for yourself, bezchut this unbelievable night, that we should all merit to not only receive our wishes, but also to merit the ultimate beracha that we see the coming of Mashiach with our own eyes. I quickly want to ask all of you, first of all, to turn off your phones. The world can wait an hour. Or in this case, probably 6 hours. When they organized the event, there wasn't a question who goes first, who goes last. The question is who's going to speak the least. I said, listen, when I open my mouth, it usually closes at 4 a.m. because everybody's asleep. But yesterday I found out, I had 7 lectures yesterday. The last one ended at 4 a.m. and I get a text message at 4 a.m. from Rabbi Yosef Reuven. He says, what, I'm not the only meshuga? There's another person awake now? So Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem, the problem is not who's going to speak, is when he's going to shut up. So I'm asking a personal request, please turn your phones on, off. But before you turn them off, I know this event, you're lucky to be here because there's probably another 50,000 people that are not lucky to be here and they're watching on the videos and on the phones. But please, if you can, we want to make an echo in the universe with this event. So take your phone real quick and share this event. Take a picture, send the link of the video. The video is broadcast on the Facebook pages of Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi and Rabbi Yaron Reuven. Go to your Facebook, take the link and share it, that not only a couple hundred people that are here will be zoche, but rather that the whole world can listen to it. I know many, many people are up now in Eretz Israel, 3 a.m, 4 a.m, we've got text messages and emailing from New Zealand, from Australia, from anywhere. Somebody sent me a text today, I don't even know how to pronounce the name of the country. So Baruch Hashem, share the event so all the world can benefit, and then turn your phone off. Now, we decided that now is the most appropriate time, since we are in the 3 weeks, to speak about the destruction of Bet HaMikdash. But we already know the Bet HaMikdash is destroyed. It's more appropriate to speak how we're building it. And while I was driving up today, and I was now a whole week in New Jersey for a tour of lectures. While I was driving up today, my daughter was telling me, what are you talking about tonight? I told her, I don't know. Whatever the Kadosh Baruch Hu wants to put in my mouth, that's what I'm going to say. I can tell you that the theme of the event is a topic by itself. We have a very severe problem in our generation of sinat chinam, baseless hate. We have many problems, but this is one of the big ones. I can talk now about all the problems on our generation, and then we'll speak Bemet Til Rosh Hashanah. But I want to focus today on a few things. And the first and most important is that we have Sinat Chinam that we can't even fathom. You know what it took to make this event? I think me and Rabbi Reuven were already talking on an event like this already for 2-3 years. Let's do an event together. You know, a few years ago, I tried to make an event, and the event theme was to get all the great rabbanim from all walks of life on one stage. All of them, Sephardi, Ashkenazi, Litai, Chabad, Breslev, you name it, all on one stage. Why? You know, in Hebrew we say, "Adag masriach me'arosh." The fish stinks from the head. If the head is separated, then the body is separated. But our main problem right now is that there's no ahdut. There's no unity. For maybe 2 years, I was trying to organize an event that we have a stage with many, many rabbanim. One stands with a shtreimel, one stands without the shtreimel, one's with the peot, and one without the peot, and one with a long coat, and one without the coat. Did you see flyers for that event? You didn't, right? Did you see the video? It was supposed to be broadcast. You know why you didn't see this event? Because every rabbi that we turn to, when you get it ready, call me. No, but we need you to help us. No, when it's done, call me. Well, then we got the most ignorant comments. Who's speaking there? Rabbi so-and-so, I'm not coming. Who's going to sit in the center? We don't know yet. I want to be in the center. I want to start. Is that rabbi there? No, I don't want to be on the same stage with him. We are so close to the coming of Mashiach that people don't even realize. Every time that I land in this land, I live in Eretz Israel, Baruch Hashem, Hashem ripped me out of this country 4 years ago after 8 years, 18 years, sorry. And every time that I land here, I lose 10,000 miles of altitude in my spiritual level. The plane just lands here. Oh, I don't even know how you live here. No offense. Not trying to hurt anybody. I do not know how you live here. I was now a whole week. Doesn't matter where.
Next week, huh?
Doesn't matter where, but Hashem Yerachem, what people care about. Some family was throwing a bar mitzvah. I was asked, they wanted me to give the bracha to the boy. I told the boy, how many mishnayot do you know off by heart? Are you going to give a pilpul in your bar mitzvah? You do a siyum? What do you care about? Which suit? Which hall? Which video? This is your bar mitzvah? I have this chut, unbelievable chut. In 3 weeks is my son's bar mitzvah, my first son's bar mitzvah. Tada Rabbah, you're all invited. I know you're not going to come, so I'm inviting you. Some of you will come. Bezrat Hashem, listen, you're all welcome. You know, somebody once told me when I was Batchala, in the beginning, Chozer B'Tshuva, I was invited to a bar mitzvah. And I saw something that really touched my heart. You know, my point tonight is that each and every one of you leave this room with something. If you came here just to look at three rabbis, then you can do that through the internet. My point is that you leave out of this room with something. Maybe this will be the something, for at least for the men. If a person would learn one Mishnah a day, it will take you 6 years to finish the Shas. So I was like, wow, that's an amazing thing. So every time one of my boys turns 7, we start learning one Mishnah a day. This is private time between me and my son. In 3 weeks, my son is doing a siyum on his bar mitzvah for the entire Shas.
Wow.
That's what people should care about. You care about what suit you wear? Nonsense. The klipa in this country, Hashem Elachem, I hope maybe after tonight, maybe I'll be able to get some of you out of here. The point is that every time that I come here, Hashem Elachem, people are living in some bubble, caring about which car they drive, how big the house is, who makes more money, he did this, he did that, who cares? It's nonsense. And why am I telling you all this? Because I once said, you know what we're missing here? We're missing Avat Chinam. We don't have Avat Chinam. A lot of people are trying to, but no, what are you talking about? Look how everybody's getting along. Nobody's getting along. I'm traveling already for the last 15 years. I lecture all around the world. There's not one community that did not badmouth the other community. Oh, you're going over there. Everybody pretends like there's some type of respect and honor to each other, but there's no respect, there's no honor, there's hate, everybody hates each other. He's from that group, he's from this group. And once I came to a very big rabbi and I told him, why can't we make an event that we get 1,000 of all the top rabbis in the world, We put them all in one room, and we say very simple, Rabotai, we all serve the same Borei Olam, the same God. We all put tefillin the same way. We all rush before Shabbat. We all do the same thing. How about I give you now my students, you give me your students, we switch students, and we make an effort of unbelievable achdut between everybody. Forget about now that what shape the hat is, how the jacket is. And I'm sure you didn't hear about that event too. You know why? Because if we would make such an event, who's the chairman? Who's the top? Who's speaking? Is the president going to be Ashkenazi or Sephardi? The sad reality is that we have such a tear in our generation, in our am, that no chance that Mashiach is going to come, b'chesed v'rachamim. As it looks from now, we're looking at a disaster. A few weeks ago, I have Baruch Hashem, a yeshiva in Eretz Yisrael, in a kolel. We decided to start learning Hilchot Lashon Hara. Why? Because every time that a person will try to do something good, everybody will go against him. I'm sure the Rabbanim po can feel, I feel for them, they feel for me. I feel like a target everywhere that I go. Why you say this? Why you say that? Don't say this, don't say that. Why are you doing like this? Why are you doing like that? So I decided to make a campaign. Let's start teaching Ilchot Lashon Hara and everything that has to do with Lashon Hara, not just Ilchot Lashon Hara. So we made an introduction, and to my great surprise, I find a Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin in the Yerushalmi that says, why was Bet HaMikdash HaRishon, the first Bet HaMikdash, destroyed? You all know, every little kid knows. Gilui Arayot, we have a lot of that in our generation. Shvihut Damim, we have a lot of that in our generation too, and Avodah Zarah, and we're flooded with that in our generation. We might not bow to statues, but you bow to your phone that I ask you to turn off, you bow to your Mercedes, you bow to your job, you bow to everything, and you think that you're not, you are. That's why Bet HaMikdash HaRishon was destroyed. Since the sin was revealed, then the length of the exile was revealed. We leave Yerushalayim, we know, the Navi says, you're going to be exiled for 70 years. Sure enough, 67 years later, the whole story with Purim, 3 years after that, exactly 70 years, we go back to Yerushalayim. 420 years later, another Bet HaMikdash destroyed. Why? Because of Sinat Chinam. The Talmud says in the Yerushalmi that it's not Sinat Chinam, it's Lashon Hara. Lashon Hara, here again the phone. Lashon Hara. Somebody asked me not too long ago, you were in Shamayim, no? You made a little visit there. What is the worst sin? I said, listen, I can give you now 50 worst sins. There's no worse sins. All the sins are worse. All the sins are bad. What, you think I'm now going to minimize a sin for you? Some people, they have a distorted way of thinking. Some guy calls me. He tried maybe 2 months to get a phone call with me. Finally gets a phone call. Baruch Hashem, I dedicate 3 to 4 hours every day for phone calls. Short phone calls, questions, consulting. He gets a phone call. People wait, Baruch Hashem, I apologize now publicly. People tell me, I send you an email. Really? Yesterday I got 3,000 emails. You think I check emails? I don't check emails. I sent you a WhatsApp, you didn't answer me. What are you talking about? I have 40,000 people on my WhatsApp. You think I will answer you? Not that I'm some, king of the world, but Baruch Hashem, busy. Nevertheless, a person asks to talk to me, and he tells me, Kvod Harav, I have a question for you. Okay, what's the question? Can I do this and this? I tell him, no. Are you sure? I told him, yes, you can't do that. This is Avera. This is a sin from the Torah. Are you 100% sure? Listen, I think I know my material pretty good. I'm sure. You know what he tells me? You're the 8th rabbi that's telling me that. What do you think I'm going to now tell you the answer you want to hear? So, we have a lot of problems in our generation, but let's go back to what I was talking about. Masechet in the Yerushalmi, it says that the sin that caused the destruction of Beit HaMikdash is Lashon Hara. Now, I told you that a few weeks ago somebody told me, what is the worst sin? I told him all the sins are worse. All the sins are bad. Don't minimize any sin. Because then you're going to have favors to some of the sins, some of the things I'm going to do, some of the things I'm not going to do. Don't do any one of them. The Mishnah says, "Eh zavir b'mitzvah kala kevachamura, she'encha yodeh matan secharan." Be very particular with any mitzvah. The easiest one to the hardest one. Why? Because you don't know what's the reward. So he tells me, okay, so what's the most important or powerful mitzvah? I says, everything is important. If you're going to minimize from the small ones, you're going to minimize from the big ones. The point is that all the mitzvot are important and all the averot you have to beware of. But I told him that if you want to hear my advice, the Kadosh Baruch Hu created us in a very sophisticated way, but in the front of our head, he put a hole. It's called a mouth. I told him, if you want to be careful of something, it's everything that goes in the mouth and everything that goes out of the mouth. David HaMelech says, "Netzor l'shonecha merah, seal your tongue from evil, v'sefatecha midaber mirma, and your lips from talking any type of deception." I told him, you want to be matzliach, you want to be successful, you want to have b'met yirat shamayim? Guard this. Whatever goes in it, and whatever goes out of it. Whatever goes in it, needless to say, this is your kosher diet. And it's not only your kosher diet, by the way. In this country, 90% of what you eat is not really food. By the way. It's all preservatives and chemicals and food coloring, and you're not really eating food. And then people don't understand why they have anxieties and weird dreams and fears and all sorts of weird reactions. Well, eat like a human being. But what comes into your mouth, mipchina shel kashrut, when it comes to kashrut, the gdolim of the gdolim were so particular with what comes into their mouth. Not to say the greatest of all, didn't even eat. The Baba Sali would fast from one day till Shabbat. From Sunday, from Motzei Shabbat to Shabbat. And just eat something on Shabbat. But what comes out of the mouth, Hashem Yerachem, what comes out of our mouth. Sly. Slandering and cheating and cursing. You put yourself to a test and you follow a few instructions. I made tshuva 18 years ago. Baruch Hashem, Hashem zikah oti, gave me an unbelievable merit to do tshuva. I don't even know why I got even such a zechut. I sometimes look at myself and I'm shocked. Me? From all people? How many people get a zechut to wake up to do tshuva? Very few people. I hope tonight maybe a few more people will get to do tshuva. But when I became observant, I didn't go to yeshiva right away. It took me about 2.5 years till I went to yeshiva. Why? Because I wasn't physically prepared to go to yeshiva. I was 27 years old, with a yetzer hara from here to Tel Aviv. How you do tshuva? Besides the fact that, first of all, just start cleaning the junk. So I started developing systems. How you do tshuva? You know, I was in yeshivot through all my life, 7 years. 4 different main yeshivot from different walks of life. Bechavana, I went to many different yeshivot. This is another thing that bothered me a lot. Every yeshiva that I went, they badmouthed the other sect. Don't learn from that book. We don't learn this book. Why? What's wrong with this book? No, 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 no. This yeshiva, we don't learn from this. I go to the next yeshiva. Oh, you were there? I didn't get any good feedback from any yeshivot that I was there. Oh, you were there? Oh, no, no, no. I want to learn this book. No, no, no. In this yeshiva, you can't learn this. David HaMelech says, Mikol melamda eskalti. So I learn from everybody. Everybody you learn from. Not from one person. Why? Because most people are so narrow. If you're not in the same group, no, I want to learn this book. This is what's called in the teachings of Kabbalah, Katnut HaMochin. The limitations of broadening your horizon. But nevertheless, I had to develop systems how to become chozer b'tshuva. How do you stop lying? How do you stop slander? How do you stop having bad thoughts? So you know what I would do? I bought a 99-cent little booklet and a pen that cost me $1.29. That's my tshuva. $2.29. And every act that I did, I wrote in this pinkas, in this little book. And every thought that I had, I wrote it. Every time I would lie, I would write the lie and the hour. Every time I would say Lashon Hara, I would write it down. So at the end of the day, I would look at it. Shem Berachem was a book. to realize how much junk is coming out of my mouth. Most people, if they will bump their leg on the table by mistake, what comes out of their mouth? You know what comes out of their mouth. They don't say ouch. They say another word. Why do you have to say that word? What benefit do you have by saying that word? Chas v'shalom, you're driving and somebody cuts you? Shem erachemo. You curse the person with every disease that exists. You already know the mother's profession. You know everything. What did the guy do? The junk that comes out of people's mouths, and then they don't understand. Lo lech li b'chaim. Nothing works in my life. You fool. Of course nothing will work out for you. Not too long ago somebody came and told me, listen, I have a tzara, I need a bracha. I told him, pray to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. What do you think, I'm the Baba Sali? No, I need you to give me a bracha. I told him, I'm not giving you anything. You need to pray. Oh, I'm already praying for 5 years. It doesn't work. I tell him, of course it doesn't work, because you lie all day long, and you say Lashon Hara all day long. Why would you think a prayer would work? You know, back in the introduction that we did to the course that we started, the series of Lashon Hara, so I pulled different sources. You know that the Zohar says that if a person says Lashon Hara, his tefillah doesn't even go up. Stay home. Don't bother to come to shul even. Stay at home. You think your tefillah is going to go up to Shemayim with the same mouth that you curse, slander, cheat, say Lashon Hara? It's not going to work. It's not going to work. David HaMelech says, Netzor Lashonecha Mera V'Sifatecha Midaber Mima. This is pearls. Zip your mouth. You know, when I became observant, I didn't know what to do. So I would fast 3 days a week, from morning to night. And then I used to take Ta'aniyot Dibur. 3 weeks, don't talk. 4 weeks, don't talk. I wasn't married. I didn't have kids. I didn't have who to talk to. I was talking to the walls. It's better not to talk. Talk to Itzik. You can't even imagine the spiritual cleansing when you guard this little hole. Hashem Erachem. I don't know if you notice, we have 2 eyes, 2 ears, 2 nostrils, 1 mouth. Shem Erachem, if we would have had 2. 1 would eat, 1 would talk. So we have a serious problem that this mouth is destructive. Now what does it cause? It causes disunity, it causes hate, it causes so much problems, jealousy. All this is, of course, it's rotting everything that exists. If you have to take something out of tonight, I told you already, on the way out, you can take CDs, souvenirs, pictures. At the end of the night, we're all going to stand, 3 of us together, you can take pictures. People already told me, can I take a picture of the 3 of you? I said, yeah, $1,500, you can take a picture with 3 of us, no problem. We'll do an auction. We'll stand like dummies, and you stand in the middle, we take a shot. So if you came to take a picture of us, then make a picture on the internet. You have to go out of this door with something. Now, I have noticed something very disturbing that I didn't like at all in myself, not in other people. And I'll share with it to you. Maybe Be'ezrat Hashem you can incorporate it into your life. The Torah promotes silence in many different ways. You know, last week I prepared one of my lectures. To prepare an hour lecture takes you 18 hours of work, 5 hours of lectures, 3 weeks. But I stumbled across a Ma'amar Chazal so powerful that it says, you know, a word is worth a lot. But not saying that word is worth much more. I'll say it again. For the ADD ones and the slow, I see some of you already. Listen, we have another 2 speakers. Let's just give a coffee here tonight. A word is worth a lot. Good morning, my dear. How are you? You just made your wife the queen of the world. Good morning, dear. How are you? Honey, you look amazing. But not saying a certain word, that's worth much more. How many times do you want to say something? And yesterday I gave a lecture, not to give too many details, but there was some type of a disagreement. And my came there, she's a watchdog, Because she has to get me to the next lecture and to the next lecture and push people away. No, I want to ask a question. You can't ask a question. Anyway, she got the vish. And what she got is the mishaberach. And she was so upset. She was crying. Don't be so upset. Our sages say about a person that is accepting a bizayon, v'shotek, and you quiet, kol avonotav nimchalim. I told you, you just went to the washing machine. Because you didn't react. You know what it is not to react? To react is very, very easy. But not to react. So I noticed in me something, and I can only talk about myself, I can't talk about other people. But at least my point is that I feel lucky enough to be able to do tshuva, so I like to at least share it with other people. Maybe other people can also do that. Because if I don't share what I have, I'm not going to get anything. At the end of the day, most people are holding everything like this, like as if it's not even yours. So I noticed in myself something that I didn't like a lot. And you know what it was? That I behave one way in public and another way in my room. Now you're all guilty in that, by the way. If we're going to put now music in this hall and we blast the music, you know what's going to happen? People are going to be like, put the same song in your room when there's nobody in the room. Suddenly you start breakdown. You invent moves that even Michael Jackson can't even do. Next to other people. Most people, they behave in the room one way, and next to other people, a completely different way. Why can't you be real? Don't you know the Kadosh Baruch Hu is looking at you? Don't you know the Kadosh Baruch Hu is looking at you, and he knows, and he's laughing and saying, who do you think you're fooling? You think you behave in a certain way, like a tzaddik, next to other people, but at home, Shem Erechem, how you behave at home. So I noticed it in myself, and I was like, how about I will start behaving in public how I behave in my room? Or better, how about I behave in my closed room how I behave in public? Should I say it again for the ADD? No? Yeah? You got it? You get a sticker out of it. I hope you're taking notes. If not, you can see the rewind. The point is that to take some teaching how to make you better, make the world a better place, because the reality is, I mean, we want to talk about Beit HaMikdash and the destruction and Mashiach. The reality is that the situation is worse than what you even can imagine in regards to how, when, what the redemption is coming. It's an unbelievable miracle that we're all still existing here and we're still breathing and we're not under a mushroom cloud. Or that the Kadosh Baruch Hu didn't destroy us already a long time ago. I don't want to say that because then Chas V'Shalom, I will raise a prosecution against Israel. But I'm sometimes shocked how the Kadosh Baruch Hu doesn't get completely upset at us with what's going on in our nation. So our situation is much worse than you think, by the way. People think, everything is okay. Life is good. Life is maybe good now. You think it's good till the storm will come. And the storm is, like I told you, it's a miracle that it didn't come yet. I'm shocked that we're still in exile and we're still not redeemed. We have some type of a zchut, we have some type of a merit, some tzaddik is praying for us, for the entire Klal Israel, that we still have the opportunity every morning to do tshuva. Most people wake up in the morning, you know what they do the first thing? I check your phone. Say modani to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Take a minute to meditate on the greatness of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, that he even did a favor to you and brought you back to the world. Some people even sleep with their phone. Why do you sleep with the phone? What's your wife? Put the phone in the living room. Turn it off. Shem Erachem. Shkuyot, the nonsense that... And most people... If you look at people's faces when they're... Then you know, I also have a phone. You see it everywhere? I don't carry it on me. I check once a day, a few hours. Why do I need to know every second to check the phone? Most people don't even value the zchut that the Kadosh Baruch Hu gives them every second. Every second, what a zchut we have that we're even alive. Most people don't realize that. You know, most people wake up in the morning, they jump on their phone. They cover the blanket over their head. from the depression, the sadness, the anxiety, the fear, the worrying, the tzarot. Now people call me and email me and text me, I have this tzarot and health and marriage and kids, and everybody gets the same answer. Pray for Mashiach. Do something for Mashiach to come. He's not coming. He's coming. Pray. Of course he's not coming, because he's sitting all day long. Why would he come? So the point we want to get from tonight, we have a very long night, but the point is how you leave the door. If you came in and you're leaving the doors the same way, then you wasted your time. You didn't come to Disneyland to watch Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. You came here tonight. No, because I know some people, they just wanted to see the show. I want to see these three rabbis on one stage. If you came for that, then you missed the opportunity. It's all how you're going out of this door. So I hope you sit tight and listen. And I'm sure there's going to be much more encouraging words tonight that you can incorporate into your life. The situation as we speak right now is that we have a sword here and we don't even notice that. Melech HaMashiach already exists, he's here in the world. He's a human being that lives in Eretz Israel. I don't think he knows his Mashiach. Some Mekubalim say he knows who he is. Some Mekubalim says he doesn't know who he are. But if Mashiach has to come tonight, he has to be a human being. And at least 13 years of age. So must be this right now, a human being, Shomer Torah and Mitzvot, in Eretz Israel, ready to get the note. V'nahal av Ruach Hashem, says the prophet. He gets the note. But as we speak right now, Am Israel has a sword here. And you're worried about your iPhone, if it's the XR or the XS or the XTZ or whatever it is, that's the nonsense. And we don't even notice that our life is in a disharmony. Be honest with yourself right now. You don't have to tell me. You don't have to tell anybody else. Be honest with yourself. Take a moment to be honest with yourself. Are you happy with your life? Most people have problems with parnasa. Most people have problems with bryut, with health, with finding their other half. Their kids are not listening to them. Yirat shamayim, yetzer hara from here to shemerachem. Everybody's dealing with something. Why? Because the Kadosh Baruch Hu is pushing everybody to a corner that you have to be pressed. Why? So you can pray for Mashiach to come. The sheker in the world is unbelievable, is almost unfathomable, it's almost even unacceptable. The sheker that you see all around, in everything. What's good is targeted as bad, what is bad gets all the kavod and all the honor and all the respect. I don't want to tell you certain things because chas v'shalom I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, but if I would share with you things that I had to go through and heard about this event. Some people, I kind of wish to know who they are just to tell them off straight to the face with things that I heard. So if you're feeling that your life is on a verge of disaster, and I bet, be honest, don't look at me, no, everything's great. No, everything is not great, by the way. You can fool anybody you want. You don't fool me. You definitely don't fool the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and if you fool yourself, you are a fool. Can make a stick out of that. If you fool yourself, you are a fool. Yeah.
Copyright.
Yeah. Chochmat. Sofrim tarbe chochmat. Why am I saying that? Because people live in denial. They lie to themselves. Lie to themselves. If they're in the world of Kedusha, then they lie to themselves. No, I can do that. On him I can say Lashon Hara. Ah, here I can lie. Stealing from him, he's a thief too. People invent all sorts of rules. They don't have a real Rav that tells them what to do and not to do. If you tell them what to do, I don't like that, they go choose a different Rav. Like as if you're making shopping for a rabbi. People call me, can you be my rabbi? I'm not nobody's rabbi. Don't call me your rabbi. I'm not your rabbi. You want, you can come and listen to a class. I'm not nobody's rabbi. No, I want you to be my rabbi. You're not going to be listening to me even to me. Why would you want to be my students? So you have to not lie to yourself about anything that happens in your life. And the main thing you cannot lie to yourself is that life is about of the verge of destruction. So again, you can be in denial and say, no, everything's fine. Now again, I'm not talking about a person that has a very good attitude, a kol letova, everything comes from the Kadosh Baruch Hu, kol man, the rachman, the avid, the tav avid, everything that Hashem does is good. Okay, listen, everything, we all have to go through nisyonot. But the reality is that everybody has a rope around their throat, in one way or another. They just don't share it with other people. Last year I was in some community, a very wealthy community. At least it seems like a wealthy community. And for some reason, I look like the Kotel HaMa'arabi. Everybody comes and whispers to me. They put notes in my jacket. Unfortunately, it's not checks. It's just notes. Can you pray for Moshe Ben Chaim? I always tell my wife, do I look like a stone to you? Everybody comes to talk to me like as if I'm the Kotel HaMa'arabi. Everybody tells me all the problems. This community, I was there for 3 days. Everybody came and told me, listen, my house is in foreclosure. I didn't pay the house already for 3 years. The banks, credit cards, I don't know what to do. But don't tell anybody. And the next one, and the next one, and the next one. Everybody's the same thing. But outside, beautiful Mercedes, beautiful houses, the most fancy watches. And I'm not making fun of anybody. I'm trying to make a point. The point is that everybody's life is shattered beneath their legs. But they're pretending that everything's okay, so everybody else can say, no, life is smooth, everything's okay. So you have to wake up and to realize nothing is okay, and everybody's suffering with something. The Kadosh Baruch Hu chose every person. Every person has at least 5 problems in their life. And if you disagree with me, you are in denial. You can disagree with me as much as you want. I don't get offended. But if you disagree with me, you're in denial. Everybody has problems. I told you already, I'm not going to repeat it. Parnasa, Yirat Shamayim, Zugiyut, marriage, finding your other half. Ooh, Hashem Erachem. The only solution is Mashiach ben David. Now, what do we do? To talk is very cheap. Our sages say, Ma'asehu Aikar. Now, we can't do things in a global level. There are a lot of people who are trying. The Etzer Hara is very, very strong. Just to get you in this room, I think it took about 5,000 text messages, 150 hours of going backwards and forth, just to make a little event. What do we want to do? Teach some Torah. What did we ask? If you now will make now an event of some nonsense, you'll have 50,000 people in one room. That's where I realized, look at that. The Yetzer Hara, the Samech Mem, is after one thing. Machloket, a disagreement. He doesn't care if you sin. By the way, the Yetzer Hara is not here to make you sin. He says, you're going to sin regardless. With or without me, you're going to sin. The Yetzer Hara, that's not his agenda. He knows you're going to sin on autopilot. His agenda is to make a machloket. This is called mecharcher riv. That he wants to make a disagreement with two people. That they don't get along. A religious and a secular, Ashkenazi and Sephardi, it doesn't matter. It's all nonsense. But the fact is, you also make an analogy in your life and you'll see how many machlokot you have in your life, how many disagreements you have in your life, and then you ask yourself a few of the cause. No, I'm a symbol of perfection. I'm the problem, he's the problem. Your Yetzer Hara is always going to tell you that he's the problem. Most people, they wake up in the morning, their eyes are like this, they look in the mirror, wow. What you did here? It's unbelievable. The ego that some people have. So when you question yourself if you are the cause of the problem in a disagreement, me? Me? I didn't do anything. His fault. The point is, like I said before, we are in a very harsh and very important time. Harsh, I'm saying, because we're still a din is hovering over our head. And don't let anybody fool you. No, Am Yisrael is doing great. No, they're not. No, there's no greatness. I'm telling you. I barely see my wife. I barely see my kids. I go from one tour to another tour. I'm in hundreds of communities. Everybody can't stand each other. Everybody slanders each other. Everybody talks about each other. And on the outside, it seems like it's on the surface is good. Now, not chas v'shalom, I'm taking away from what we do have. No, I know I speak a little bit negative and harsh, but I'm not taking away from the greatness of our generation. There's never been so much Torah in our generation. Hundreds of millions of hours on the internet of Torah. Yeshivot from here to tomorrow. Shabbat, where I was in Shabbat, unbelievable. Come 7 o'clock in the morning to the Beknesset. 500 people learning Torah. We have access to any book you want. 100 years ago, who had books? So I'm not negating from the fact that we have a lot of Torah in our generation. We have a lot of chesed in our generation. We have a lot of good things. But it's so diluted with all the bad, so it's almost nothing. I'm going to sidetrack for a second because a lot of people ask me on my own personal story, my own personal experience. I'm sure some of you heard it, or maybe all of you, and if you didn't, then take a CD and listen to it. But that's not the point. The point is, a lot of people tell me, why in Shamayim they judge you so hard? You are Tinok Shenishba, no? You were born secular. What do they want from you? So first of all, and most important, is they didn't judge me for what I didn't know. They judged me for what I knew. They didn't show me if I put filling or not. They didn't show me that I was ripping letters on Shabbat or cooking on Shabbat. You know what they showed me? Beikar ben adam lechavero. Between one person to another person. You need the Torah to be a mensch. You need the Torah to tell you not to steal. Go not to the street. Take any goy. Normal one. A good one. Tell me, is that okay to steal? Chas v'shalom. Heaven forbid. Go now to any country in the world. You ask a normal human being, is that okay to commit adultery? Ma pitom. You need the Torah for that? You don't need the Torah for that. And of course, everybody are my senegorim. In every lecture that I did about my personal story, everybody's my senegorim. Why are they so mean? Why are they so harsh? Why did they judge you? Where were you when I was in Shamayim, when I needed some senegorim? There was no senegorim. This is called in Hebrew, yafei nefesh. Why are you pretending? Now, what is my answer? Yes, I did have a few mitzvot. They showed me a few mitzvot that I had. But my analogy, and that's connected to what I'm trying to tell you, because we do have a lot of good things in our generation. Baruch Hashem, there's a lot of Torah, a lot of chesed, a lot of kiruv. Not enough, but we do have. If you take now a bottle of Coca-Cola, and you pour in it a cup of water, would it change the color of the Coca-Cola? No. But take a bottle of water like this and pour in it 2 drops of Coca-Cola. 2 drops! The whole water is brown. And if you put a cup, the whole water is completely dark. Which means that it doesn't matter how much good you have, you drop in 1 drop of bad, the whole water is dirty. All the good that you did is already dirty. And if you have a lot of bad, you throw in a lot of good. It's not going to change anything. It's be'ayin aroch. Not comparison. So don't for 1 second take my words out of context and say, well, why is this slandering the whole generation? We have Am Yisrael is doing great. I'm not saying that. Baruch Hashem, we have great Rabbanim and great Chachamim in the Torah. We have a lot of good things. I'm looking now at the bad things, only the good things. If you look only at the good things, you don't get better. You have to look at the bad things. Be'ayin aroch. Not comparison. So don't for 1 second take... Now, let's go back a few weeks. We are finishing now the book of Bamidbar. Fascinating book. The book of Bereshit is the creation of the world and the building of our nation. The book of Shemot is being in Mitzrayim as Avadim, as slaves, and then going out of Mitzrayim. And the beginning of the desert. The book of Vayikra mainly focuses on mitzvot. And specifically about the building of the Mishkan, the Mizbeach, the Korbanot, and so forth. The book of Bamidbar is exactly how it sounds. Bamidbar, in the desert. Don't you wonder what was going on there for 40 years? What did they do there? You think they were playing sheshbash in the desert? What they were doing there for 40 years? Okay, the desert. The book of Vayikra, mainly for years. So first of all, we have Parashat Shlach, talking Lashon Hara. Parashat Chukat, talking Lashon Hara. Parashat Korach, talking Lashon Hara. Any other things but slandering each other? This is what's going on in the desert. Everybody's talking against each other, and against who? Against the Gdol Ador. Where do you come up with such a chutzpah to talk about this against the Gdol Ador? The din that it brings on Am Yisrael to talk about Gdol Ador, Moshe Rabbeinu. And you think anything changed in our generation? We are exactly a replica of 3,300 years ago. By the way, 80% of the nation did not leave Mitzrayim. You know why? Moshe Rabbeinu came all excited. Chevre, we're going out. Digi azman geulatechem. I came to take you out. Where are we going? We're going to the desert. 80% asked the same question. Is there Wi-Fi in the desert? Is there Wi-Fi in the desert? No. Not coming. How am I going to check my messages? Yeah, I mean, you're laughing. You should cry. 80% was left behind. Why? Because they were stuck in their Mitzrayim. Mitzrayim is not a country, by the way. Mitzrayim is a state of mind La'ari HaKadosh explains Mitzrayim comes from the word Meitzar. Meitzar is a limit. In our generation, they call it in a different name. It's just a very sensitive name, and people get very upset when you tell them that. Meitzar means an addiction. Everybody's addicted to something, by the way. I'm not talking right now heroin, crack, alcohol, gambling. I'm not talking about that. That's Hashem Yirachem, what's going on in our generation. But people are addicted to food, to clothes, to Facebook, to their phone, to I don't know what. And I'm not blaming anybody, and I'm not chas v'shalom making a joke on everybody. But the whole point of Yetziat Mitzrayim is that I go out of my limitation. Out of the state that limits me. And you know what's the worst Mitzrayim that everybody has? Judgmental. Jealousy. Slandering. That's a Mitzrayim, by the way. That's a Mitzrayim. You know how judgmental you are? This Shabbat I was somewhere. There was a big Shabbaton and there was a lot of events. Back-to-back classes. One class I come. It was me, a few other people. And then you see a couple coming in. Somebody says, who are these? They're not from the community. What if somebody says, ay, look at that. They drove on Shabbat. That couple slept over in somebody's house. Why you judge them? They got so offended, they didn't come to the class. Why you judge them? How you know they drove on Shabbat? And you know, because of you, they didn't come to the class. We're so judgmental. By the way, that's an addiction too. Everything that limits you, that's an addiction. And again, another state of denial. Most people say, oh, me, I'm addicted. Yeah, let's see you put your phone down for 3 days. Give me your phone for 3 days. I'm here till Monday. Give me the phone. I'll give it back to you in the last lecture on Monday. Let's see you survive without your phone. But why am I saying all that? Because people who are numb or sleeping, you can call it denial too, they don't understand in what state they are. So they need a slap to their face to wake up, to understand it. Whoa, what was going on? Well, you are sleeping, my friend. You're in denial. So 3,300 years, nothing changed. We are still in Mitzrayim. Don't be from those 80% that stays behind, because the Geulah is coming any minute. And doesn't mean that everybody's going to be on board. I know there's beautiful slogans, Kol Yisrael, Yesh Lahem Chelek La'olam Haba. These are good for stickers, by the way. Read the rest of the Pasuk, by the way. You know, there's a famous story with the Chafetz Chaim. Somebody came to him and told him, Kvod HaRav, I just read a Mishnah that says, Kol Yisrael Yesh Lahem Chelek La'olam Haba. Why should I do anything? I have a Chelek La'olam Haba, no? I sit here and play all day long, and I'll get to Olam Haba. What does he answer him? He tells him a story. There was once a person who was very, very wealthy, and he had a lot of textile company and plants, and it's a real story. And all over Russia, that was his business, multi-millionaire. Now his thing was that he would give a job to any family member. You're a family member, you get a job. Okay. One time he goes to visit some of the plants. You know, the CEO comes with all the entourage. He walks into the plant. He doesn't know anybody. He doesn't know his workers. He comes to one of them. Hello, who are you? My name is so-and-so. What do you do here? I'm the manager of marketing. Nice to meet you. Goes to another person. What do you do here? I'm the manager of production. FMO, nice to meet you. Goes through one to another. Then he comes to one person. He sees him sitting on the chair. He tells him, what do you do here? He's like, I don't do nothing. He's like, what do you mean? And you get a salary? Yeah, of course I get a salary. You don't do something and you get a salary? How come? He says, well, I'm your cousin. The Chafetz Chaim tells this man, do you want to be like a cousin that doesn't do anything? What did you come to this world for? What did you come to the world for? To do nothing? So you'll get a little piece in the Olam Haba. Who says what piece you're going to get? But you came here to the world to do nothing. On the same note, there's another story. Hashem Erechem, 80 years ago, was a Holocaust. Don't think for 1 second that that's the last Holocaust. We are in the verge of maybe another one. Don't live in denial, by the way. Don't let people tell you, never again. Never again? Look how many Holocausts we had in our history. But nevertheless, famous story about Rabbi Elchanan Wasserman, the student of the Chafetz Chaim. He ran out of Europe, he came to America. You know why? Because he wanted to fundraise. He had a yeshiva, he wanted to smuggle people out. To make a very long story short, he found out about a friend of his that was in America and happened to be very, very wealthy. Okay. He looks him up, he tries to get an appointment. Of course, he goes through the first layer of filter, the second layer of the filter, all the runarounds, he can't talk to you. I mean, this is like calling now some big macher, some big shot. Finally, he tells them, listen, my name is Elchanan Wasserman, I learned with this individual in Cheder, we're friends. Okay, somehow he gets into the meeting, hugging and kissing and hugging and kissing. He's looking at the man. The man is completely secular. Doesn't eat kosher, doesn't observe Shabbat, doesn't put tefillin, nothing. Bekitzur, he tells him, what do you do? He says, I came here to America, I didn't have nothing. And what did I do? To make a very long story short, he says, I had some money, I bought a broken sewing machine, and I was very technical, I fixed up the sewing machine, and then I started fixing people's coats, and then I bought another sewing machine and another sewing machine. Before I know it, I had a lot of sewing machines, and I started fixing people's raincoats, and then I started making raincoats, and blah, blah, blah. Before I know it, look, now I'm a millionaire. Okay. Rabbi Chanan Wasserman was not a fool. The friend tells him, tell me, why didn't you come to see me? He says, just came to say hello. You just came to say hello? Yeah. You came all the way from Europe. Hundreds of rubles to go on a boat to come and say hello? He says, yeah, my friend from Cheder, hello. And he leaves. Now this guy drives him nuts. He can't go to sleep. He can't work. What? He came all the way here to say hello? He tells his secretary the next day, get this guy, get him. I need him back. I need to know why he came here. He calls him back and he tells him, you have to tell me. Why did you come here? I says, I came here to say hello. No, Bebe, listen, I'm no fool. Why did you come here? So he says, you know what? You see this button here? It's a little bit loose. I thought maybe you can sew it. He says, you came all the way from burning Europe for me to sew to you a button? I don't believe you. He says, yeah, can you sew me the button? Look, it's a little bit loose. Really, why did you come here? He says, I came here for you to strengthen my button. He gets upset. Tell me, why did you come here? He tells him, are you listening to yourself? You are shocked that I came here to sew a button? You think you came to this world to sew some buttons? That's why you came to the world, to sew a few buttons? Needless to say, the man broke down in tears. Tells him, listen, I didn't learn Torah for years. Set and learn Torah with me. I want to put tefillin on. And needless to say, figured out how wrong he was and how bad he went off the path. And then, of course, he told him, listen, how can I reward you? He told him, well, I have a big yeshiva in Europe. I need a lot of money. What did he tell him? The next 3 years of yeshiva is covered. All the expenses. But such a tzaddik went back to Europe and died and was murdered there on Kiddush Hashem. Rabbi Elchanan Wasserman. What do we want to take from all this? I can bemet. I spoke maybe 1% of what I wanted to say. But now it's time for me to, like I told you before, be quiet. But I really want to leave you with a few powerful things that you can go out of this door tonight. First, I told you, you watch this thing. Second of all, I told you, watch how you behave on the street and how you behave in your home. Don't be a fool. Don't be a hypocrite. Don't pretend. The way you behave in the street, behave like this in your room. Have the Yirat Shamayim. That the same way the people around you looking at you, and you suddenly you're standing all nice and you're praying like a... Let's see how you pray when you're by yourself, if you even pray. Don't be a hypocrite and don't behave in the street one way and in the room another way. But the most important thing, we have to understand that we, as a klal, can make a huge noise. If you have one person screaming, you can hear. You have 1,000 people screaming, you can hear. So everybody has to scream in their way. Am Israel is standing in front of Kelaya, in front of a Holocaust. I'm not joking. That's the reality. We need to scream. We need to scream to the Kadosh Baruch Hu to save us. to send the Geula. You scream with Ahavat Hashem, you scream with Yirat Shamayim, you scream with learning Torah, you scream with spreading Torah. It says in Masechet Sanhedrin, if you want to know about what's going on, we're in the verge of a war. This war is called Gog u'Magog. I wanted to talk about that, but there's really no time. You know, you don't feel that maybe here. I live 30 kilometers from the border. Every day, the jets are flying. Every day, you know, we feel sometimes the ground shaking. You don't feel it here. But don't discount for one second that this country is not on the target. This country is not safe. Don't think that people say, oh, that's Israel, it's so dangerous there. No, it's not. The Meraglim, that spoke Lashon Hara about Eretz Yisrael, up until today, Kadosh Baruch Hu didn't forgive them. Kadosh Baruch Hu forgave for the golden calf, for Chet HaEgel. Kadosh Baruch Hu forgave for many other things. There's one sin that up until today we never got forgiveness for. And that's Chet HaMeraglim. Hashem says, you talk Lashon Hara about my land? I'll never forgive you. So don't dare to talk Lashon Hara about Eretz Yisrael. It's dangerous there. No, it's not. It's safer there than here. But I live next to the border. And I'm not exaggerating. Sometimes twice a day we see the jets flying. What's going on now in Syria? Exactly like all the prophecies. Famous prophecy of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. This can be found in a book called Otzar Midrashim, page 555. He says, Hine lecha avot, here's for you a sign. When you want to know when the Ben David Magia, the son of David, Mashiach is coming. When is he coming? When there's going to be a war. Samuch l'Yerushalayim. There's going to be a war next to Yerushalayim. And when the ruler of Damascus will fall down, will come Mashiach ben David, Goel Israel, the Redeemer of the Jews. Damascus, that sounds pretty familiar. I mean, in English it says Damascus. Damascus. Now, interestingly, he says his name of the ruler of Damascus, Niron Mizrachi. Niron Mizrachi? I know you're Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi. I don't know, Niron Mizrachi. Make a quick calculation of the gematria of Niron Mizrachi, 571. Don't pull your calculators out. Who's the ruler of Syria of Damascus? Bashar Assad. The same numerical value of 571. Same gematria. Niron Mizrachi and Bashar Assad. When Assad is going to fall very soon, that's when the Redeemer is going to come. But don't think for one second we're not in the middle of the war. The war is happening as we speak. And don't think there's no nuclear submarines in front of the coast of Los Angeles and New York. Don't think for one second that you're here under some umbrella of Donald Trump. It's an unbelievable miracle even that we're even here and he won. I don't know how the other one, somehow, I'm shocked with what I see. I'm sure some of you attended my lecture 3 years ago and I told people, run away from here. This Nazi, this Meshuga, the president, he's going to turn this whole place upside down. Unbelievable miracle. I don't even know how, what schut we had, somehow. And I don't want to get into politics, but and don't think I'm a Trump supporter. Now people are saying, I support Trump. Nothing to do with, I'm not a supporting, I support the Kadosh Baruch Hu. I don't support any politician. Trump is a puppet, but at least he's a good puppet, at least so far, till he will get his Janana. I don't know how you translate Janana in English. The screws will go loose. The point is that we are in the verge, we're in the middle of Gog u'Magog. Maybe later we'll have time, we'll more go into depth in that. But I'm just going to finish with one thing. It says in Masechet Sanhedrin, talks about Gog u'Magog, page 87, 88, 89. Arotel inatzel mi Gog u'Magog. A person that wants to be saved from Gog u'Magog. And don't think that Gog u'Magog is just nuclear bombs. By the way, Gog u'Magog is the junk that's going on in your mind. The thoughts that you have all day long. Shem Erachem, what's going on in people's thoughts? I gave a class not too long ago, somebody made like a Geula summit. A lot of Rabbanim, it was very nice, Baruch Hashem. So my theme was about the thoughts, how the thoughts are very powerful. And I quoted a certain tzaddik, a Rebbe from Piasetzna, that has a whole a meditation system that is called Hashkata, how to quiet your thoughts. You know what he says there? He says that most people, the junk that's going on in their mind, is not different from any lunatic. The only difference between us and lunatics is that lunatics do what they think. You don't do what you think. It stays here. What do you want to do to that person? What do you want to say to that person? So Gog u'Magog, by the way, is not only the bombs, it's also what's going on in your thoughts. The Zohar says, Milchemet Gigim, war of thoughts. But Arotzeli Natzel Mi Gog u'Magog, you want to be saved? יעסוק בתורה הוא גמילות חסדים. יעסוק בתורה, learn תורה. If you listen to my lectures, you know that I always say, if you don't learn minimum 2 hours a day Torah, this is less than 2 hours a day, and you didn't even warm the engine. What can you do in 2 hours? And don't tell me, now 2 hours, what is he talking about? I know people that are busier than you, and they learn 5 hours. Anybody can learn. Instead of being 3 hours on Facebook, be 5 minutes on Facebook and learn the other 2.5 hours. Ya'asok b'Torah. And the Torah is everything. Torah is also tefillah. 3 times a day to be in a minyan, not to pray at home. But gemilut chasadim, real gemilut chasadim. Only know it's the real gemilut chasadim. Our sages say gemilut chasadim is when you go and you care about another person's well-being. Not about your well-being, somebody else's well-being. Did you go out of your way? So I'm going to leave you with a short message that we are in the verge of the redemption coming. It's in our hands. Can you imagine how excited, what a time? Moshe Rabbeinu, Tzadikim, all the Tanaim HaKadoshim, Geonim, prophets, everybody waiting for Mashiach. And we're going to see it. I hope that everybody will see it. Amen. I wish for all of us to see the coming of Mashiach with their own eyes. But you didn't come to this world to polish buttons. You didn't come to this world to sew a coat. You came to this world to change the world, to learn Torah, to spread Torah, and to do gemilut chasadim amitit, real gemilut chasadim. And there's so much opportunities. You don't have to do it by yourself. You have money, you give your money. You have time, you give your time. You have a profession, give your profession. You have a couch, give it to somebody who needs to rest. It doesn't matter how you do it. If you cannot conclude the day with 5 acts of kindness, don't go to sleep. With me by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, if I can't count 10, 15 acts of chasadim, well, what's going on? It's the middle of the day. I didn't do enough chasadim. So we have an unbelievable opportunity. I do believe that this night is very, very powerful, not because the message, because of the fact that there's a lot of people together. And that's our secret, achdut, the unity. It doesn't matter how I dress, which rabbi I follow, how do I pronounce my words? Do I say oh or oi? Doesn't matter. Respect me, love me, accept me for being a good Yirei Shamayim Jew. Stop being judgmental. Stop being jealous. Stop looking at another person, what is he doing? Look at yourself, what you're doing. And if we do one little more act that of achdut, and it starts with you. It doesn't start with the big. It starts with you. Tonight we have a great opportunity to show achdut. Like I told you in the beginning, you know how many rabbis I tried to get together? Achdut, that's it. And achdut is a big word. But we have to have unity, even if I dislike you. Even if I don't appreciate what you say. As long as it's in the path of the Torah, by the way. Don't take my words and distort them. It has to be in the path of the Torah. I drove in Tel Aviv, I gave an Eretz Israel. I went not too long ago to give a lecture in Eretz Israel. I drove in Tel Aviv, and ran me to Tel Aviv. Shem Arachem, you have to go like this in Tel Aviv. And then I see this stupid flag, excuse me that I'm using this language, that just gets me upset to even think about it. This colorful flag. Ve'ahavta le'recha kamocha. Are you kidding me? Sorry, you're laughing. I don't know. I'm crying when I see that. Ve'ahavta le'recha kamocha, you chutzpan. And all Tel Aviv is ve'ahavta le'recha kamocha. So, don't take any of my words out of context. It has to be in the line in the Torah. You follow the Torah, and you are a true chassid of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and you are not in my group, azma. Azma if you're not in my group. Lehefer, teach me what your rabbi is teaching. Show me the beauty of your keilah. Now I was in a beautiful keilah on Shabbat. They brought rabbanim from a different keilah. This is a Sephardi keilah. They brought Ashkenazi rabbanim. I was so, wow. Look at this beautiful achdot. Everybody respecting each other. So you come from a Eastern European descent, and you come from Iraq. Ma ze meshane? Our problem is this unity. So the same way that you're sitting here tonight in achdut, then that has to be applied when you leave the night. And it can only be done when your mind is clean. No jealousy, no judgmental, no bad thoughts, and it's all here. All in the mouth. Don't talk for 1 week, I guarantee to you. You're going to be a whole different person. Watch what goes into your mouth for 1 week and watch what goes out of your mouth for 1 week. You'll be a whole different person. No more junk thoughts in your mind all day long. No anxiety and fears and... Achdut. I'm going to finish with a blessing. First of all, again, I want to thank Borei Olam, the master of the universe, that even allowed such an event to actually happen. My theory, you know why Mashiach, that's my theory. Mashiach is Eretz Israel, by the way, guarantee, no question about. There's no question. And I bet you that every morning he wakes up and he puts his suit on and he says to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, today is the day, right? Hashem tells him, listen, I looked on Facebook and I saw that there's about 1,000 lectures going to be tonight. You know how many people will be inspired tonight to do tshuva? Maybe if you wait one day, then we'll have another 1,000 balei tshuva. So Mashiach says, okay, no, yalla, kibalta, you got. But at some point, he's going to run out of patience. So don't waste your time. Your time is valuable. Your thoughts are valuable. Your speech is valuable. Your actions are valuable. Don't discount what you do. Don't discount the negative things that you do. Make a huge change. Because if we don't make a change, Shem Erechem, what are we looking at? Look at history. Just look at history. So I hope you're going to leave this door tonight with a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of attitude, that you can say, I can be the one that will change something in this world. And you start with your mouth. And that will affect everything. So I'm going to use this mouth to give you a beracha, that we should all be successful in everything that you do, that your task in this world will be clear to you.
Amen.
That you'll be able to reach to your ultimate tikkun, that you'll be the one that Mashiach comes and shakes his hand for the men. And the, no amen, for the men. Now people, somebody sent me a video, some cuckoo woman that is announcing to the world, I am the Mashiach. Lady, I know you're shocked. Of course I'm shocked from the stupidity. I said men, not amen. But you want to be the one that Melech HaMashiach tells you, Toda Rabah. Toda Rabah. Toda Rabah that you went out of your comfort zone to make me come faster. So you'll be the one. So tonight you're going to leave this night Be'ezrat Hashem with a change in your mind, a change in your heart. I can tell you already that the force that is trying to lighten up the world, the force of Torah and Kiruv, is fighting the powers of impurity with their teeth. We can't do it by ourselves, by the way. People thank me. Don't thank me. I just stand here. My leg hurts me, but I'm standing here. Thank my wife, first of all, and then thank the people behind me that is pushing the system. Because without the people behind me pushing the system, nothing works. So you have an opportunity not just to go like this. I can tell you so many jokes. We didn't come here for jokes. We came here for actions. So team up. Bechavana, we have here such a powerful combination. Then join us. Join the support. Join the effort. I'm telling you, we can change the world. The Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says, we only need a small group. Knishtahada. One group. And we can change the world. So I wish you again great success in everything that you do. Don't discount the fact that you are here. Don't think that you're here because you saw a flyer or you got an invitation in WhatsApp. Because the Kadosh Baruch Hu invited you to come here. A personal invitation. You know, if people wanted to come and couldn't come. And I bet you that half of them are watching now the set at the movie and saying, ah, I wish I could be there. You were invited here personally, so you come out of this room different. And if you didn't, you wasted a chair. We could have given the chair to somebody else. So make a change. Make a change in your life. Make a change in everybody's life. Make a change in the status of Am Yisrael and help bring the redemption. Amen. Thank you. Bless you. Before I give the podium to my fellow friend, Reuven, who came all the way from Florida, quick announcements on the way out. I didn't quite see, but I can guarantee to you that there are beautiful tables with all of our tables, with CDs, with books, with pamphlets, with whatever you want. Take as much as you can. I came here with 18,000 CDs. My poor back, carrying everything with it. I bring them from Eretz Israel. So my money goes to Eretz Israel. Take the CDs, they're all for free. I'm sure that all the CDs are free. Participate in everything that we do. We're going to have here a Shabbaton on Shabbat if you want to join us. There's going to be lectures throughout the week. I think, Rav, are you staying here?
No, just till today.
So Bezal Hashem, I'm here till Monday. There's many more lectures. You can look it online. There's going to be here a Shabbaton for Shabbat. We're going to have lectures and a meal and everything. And Bezal Hashem, take all this, the videos from here, share it, spread it with your friends. And Bezal Hashem, let's stir the world. Bezal Rabbah, everybody.
First of all, Bershut HaRabbanim, the event really was 2-3 years in the making. And 2-3 years in the making. Lots going on, lots of moving parts. Baruch Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, He gives you everything when you need it, not necessarily when you want it. So apparently we need it today. Why do we need it today? So, Rav Anava said the idea behind the theme behind everything, he thought maybe unity. So, as he said, unity in Hebrew is achdut. Achdut, oneness. We have to be united. United to bring Mashiach, united to overcome our obstacles, and so on and so forth. Now, people always ask, how come Mashiach didn't come? Well, first of all, one sign that he's Jewish is that he's late 2,000 years. But more importantly, Chazal tell us that the Mashiach doesn't want to come for a generation of burim ve'amei haratzot. He does not want to come to a generation of ignorant people who do not know Ratzon Hashem. Now, why ignorant? Because if you notice, most people know the word unity. Most people know, they've heard the word unity somewhere. Most people have heard the pasuk you read on Shabbat, Kol Yisrael Yishlem Chelek La'olam Haba. Most people have heard this. How many people could actually define either one? Very few. Kol Yisrael Yesh Lehem Chelek La'olam Haba was said by the Prophet. But then it says, Ve'amech Kulam Tzadikim. But then it says that, who has the share of the world to come? The Tzadikim. You have to read the rest of the Pasuk. That's the trick. The trick is to entice you to read the rest. Achdut is a wonderful thing you can make a bumper sticker on. The key, the trick is to understand what it means. What does unity mean? Now I actually went in a dictionary, Webster dictionary, if people still use it. I think it was the first one in years. Unity does not mean that we both do the same thing. It doesn't mean that. Most people, you ask them, what's unity? Oh, me and you on the same team. No, it doesn't mean that. Unity doesn't mean that both you and me think alike. It doesn't mean that. I think my way, he thinks his way, Kodarav thinks this way, everybody thinks their own way. What, you think Hashem is going to make robots? He already has Malachim. Unity doesn't mean we think the same way. Unity does not mean that we're all part of the same Hasidut. Doesn't mean that. Unity does not mean that we're all part of the same Keilah. Unity means we have a common goal. How we get there, that's your business. You want to teach Torah and Musar to get people to do tshuva? Ashrecha v'ashrecha kecha. You want to teach real chassidut To get people to do tshuva, ashrecha v'ashrecha kecha. You want to tell jokes and somehow miraculously get people to keep Shabbat? I have no idea how that works, and I'm not good at jokes. But you want to do it, ashrecha v'ashrecha kecha. But the key is, can you get people to do tshuva? Do you have results? Or are you just collecting money? Or are you just here to collect checks? And you want a popularity contest because people press like on your YouTube page. What are you looking for? You're looking for likes? So you write a book with anashim tmeim, with unkosher people? Because that's what's going to get likes and people to buy your book? Or are you actually getting results? Achdut means that we all are supposed to align our own actions to have that common goal, which is to get Am Yisrael to finally do tshuva. That's supposed to be the goal of every keilah, whether you're secular or you're religious or you're Hasidish or you're Litvish or whatever you are, you're from Mars. That's your job too. Even if you're not Jewish, that's your job too. Why? Unless we do tshuva, nothing good's gonna happen. Now, last night I had a lecture about a very, very interesting topic that no one really wants to talk about except the people on the stage. It's called Pgama Brit. In the English language, you are simply not going to find anything about it. Hebrew, Baruch Hashem. English, it's almost non-existent. But according to the Shulchan Aruch, it's the worst sin in the Torah. So how can it be that an entire generation of Jewish people does not know about something that the Shulchan Aruch, Rabbi Yosef Karo, says this is the worst of the worst? I have Avrechim. Avrechim went to Kollel, in Kollel, 5, 10, 15 years. Just discovered Pgama Brit from my lecture on YouTube. Rabbis of Keilot. They have 500 people coming to them every week. Discovered Pgama Brit from some guy that did tshuva like 2 days ago. Yaron Reuven. Hey, he did tshuva, so he taught about Pgama Brit. How? What happened? How do we have this? How do we have a generation of burim v'amei haratzot? I'll tell you my idea. For the 2 cents that it's worth. As the Rav said, everybody's got such a big ego that if it's not my idea, then I don't like it. Yeah, but is it a good idea? Yeah, but it's not my idea. Okay, it's not your idea. But is it a good idea? Is it emet? Is it what the Torah says? Yeah, it says it's in the Torah that this is not good, but maybe it's too hard for people. Well, don't you think Hashem knew that? When he wrote the Torah and he said, this is mitzvah, this is mitzvah, this is avera, this did he took it in cheshbon that, you know, somebody's going to have a car one day and he wants to drive on Shabbat? Or he just made that rule just because Moshe Rabbeinu didn't have a car? HaKadosh Baruch Hu knew everything from day one. The problem is that our ego sometimes is so big that we forget what's the point of what we're doing. Now, all of us know the first part of this pasuk. Parashat Ekev says, "Ve'achalta ve'savata ve'ubirachta et Adonai Elohecha al ha'aretz ha'tova asher natan la." Everybody knows this pasuk. This is one of the sources for Birkat HaMazon. Everybody knows this pasuk. Very few knew the second half. But I'll tell you. Free. ישמר לך פן תשכח את אדוני אלוהיך לבלתי שמור מצוותיו ומשפטיו וחוקיו אשר אנוכי מצווך. Translation. הקדוש ברוך הוא says to us, you will eat and you will be satisfied and bless Hashem your God for the good land that he gave you. That's the first half. Everybody knows. That's the source of what we know. That's a mitzvah from the Torah to do Birkat HaMazon. But the second half it says, take care lest you forget Hashem, your God, by not observing His commandments, His ordinances, His decrees, which I command you today. Now let me ask you guys a question. I'm having a little bit of an issue here. Who's Hashem? Who's he talking to? Is he talking to the atheist that came to my lecture yesterday and tried to debate me? Is he talking to the Christians that believe some moron died 2,000 years ago and therefore that made him God? Is he talking to, what, the people that have the gay flags all over the world and are doing a big chilul Hashem? Who is he talking to? He's talking to us. He's talking to the people that are trying to be Shomer Torah Mitzvot. He's talking to the religious people, or at least the ones that are trying to be. And he's telling you, by the way, you ate, you have panasa, you prayed for it 500 times panasa. For Mashiach, not even once, but for panasa, 500 times. For Am Yisrael to do tshuva, you forgot. You forgot, but by accident, it's part of your Amidah. But for panasa, 5,000 times. Okay, so you got the panasa. Kapara alecha, you got panasa. Good. Okay, now, what about the rest? What about the rest? Did you forget me? What do you mean that I forget you? How could I forget you? You gave me money, Hashem. How could I forget? If a Kadosh Baruch Hu wrote in his Torah, I gave you Parnassah, and by the way, don't forget me. Why did he write this? Obviously, it means that it's true. It means that, yes, he gave us the Parnassah, that $500,000 house you have, or in New York, $1 million house you have. I have to, you know, designate where I'm talking to. Florida, 500,000. New York, million plus. That $1 million house, Baruch Hashem, you got. The Mercedes, the BMW, the whatever W, all those W's. In your parking lot, that. The 6 cars you're paying a lease of $5,000 a month, but you can only drive one car. You got that, right? The stock portfolio that you keep looking at 500 times a day after Facebook. You have that too, the IRA, the 401k, the broker that you called, the broker that you just fired, all those people, you got it, right? So how come you forgot me? How could it be that we forgot Hashem? Hashem is saying we forgot him. Don't forget me. Why? Rabotai Yekarim, we have a generation of Burim and Amei Aratzot, not because we don't know who Moshe Rabbeinu is. Everybody knows who Moshe Rabbeinu is, even the atheist. Believe or not believe, it's a different story. We don't have a generation of Burim v'Amei Aratzot, of ignorant people who don't know who Hashem is. Even the atheist, B'toch Tocho, believes that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is real. It's just that he's going to declare it later on when he's on his deathbed. It's not that we don't know Torah. That we don't know how to use it. We don't know what's mamash, how does it affect our life. We know stories. We know different things and mitzvot. Why? We're not really so sure. So, HaKadosh Baruch Hu told the prophet again, later on, prophet Isaiah, I'm going to give you another sign. I'm talking to the religious people. In their mouth and their lips, they honored me, but really, in their hearts, they're far away from me. He's not talking to the secular. He's not talking to the gay clubs. He's not talking to the Nutzrim. He's not talking to all of the atheists. He's talking to us. You say Baruch Hashem every time somebody says, how you doing? Baruch Hashem. Where are you going to go? Be'ezrat Hashem. Everybody says those words. You're even going to sing a song. Akados. Everybody knows that song. But how many of you actually believe it in your heart? How many of you invest as much time on Zikui Arabim to help your fellow brother do tshuva as you do researching the next stock to invest in? Stock to invest in? At least 2 hours a day. Helping people do tshuva, yeah, I think I pressed like on our YouTube page somehow. Yeah, I did it, Rabbi. I pressed like. Is that good? We'll see. When you go up to Shamayim, which one you can take with you, the like or the IRA account? So the reality is, Rabotai, is that it's not a matter of just simple knowledge. It's also a matter of ideology. It's a matter of how to apply the mitzvot when push comes to shove. Yesterday I had a guy come to the shul, and from the looks of it and the sounds of it, you would be, it'd be very hard to believe that the guy even keeps Shabbat. But after we had a serious conversation, he tells me he's 10 masechtot away from finishing the entire Shas. But the way he sounded, the way he looked, the way the information he portrayed, it seems like I don't know what Shas he's learning. But apparently it's Talmud Bavli. Maybe it's in Bavel still. I don't know. Maybe it's the Babylonian actual still language. I'm not really sure. Why? Because the ideology that's in the Talmud and the ideology that's in the person don't match. So I ask him, how is it that you're having this issue? He says, listen, the rabbis told me I should go to the AA meeting in the church. I said, who? What? A rabbi told you to go to a church? He goes, yeah, the AA meeting. I said, for whatever reason, you can't go to a church. He says, well, the same other rabbi told me that if I have a desire and I'm, you know, I'm really like about to like do like something bad on Shabbat, I should call somebody. Maybe they'll give me chizuk. I said, wait, hold on a second. A rabbi told you to be a mechalel Shabbat because that's somehow going to help you? A desire has now turned into a pikuach nefesh? Who are these rabbis? Where do you go? Is the rabbi in the church also? Is he giving the AA meeting or is one of the students? So first and foremost, Rabotai Yekarim, we did a series, and the CDs are outside. It's called Mishnah Pirkei Avot, Musar Pirkei Avot. We did an entire series about Pirkei Avot, as the rabbis as well have done. We went into each Mishnah. Average lecture is almost 3 hours. One of the lectures says, Aseh Lecharav, make yourself a rabbi. What does it mean, make yourself a rabbi? Make sure before you declare anybody a rabbi that you're going to learn from, whether it's directly or indirectly, you're going to listen to this shiurim or you're going to publicize this Torah, make sure you use your mind a little bit. Does he say what HaKadosh Baruch Hu said? Or does he say his opinion? If he says what HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, you're repeating it, you're just publicizing Torah. If he says his opinion and his version and his, you know, whatever he understood out of it and he's picking and choosing, then we have ourselves a problem. So before you pick a rabbi, you have to make sure that you at least investigate just as much as you investigate the next house you want to buy and the next stock you want to invest in. Investigate just a little bit. In the English language, you're not going to have that much of a difficulty because you can tell the difference between the two very quickly. One tells you go to mixed dancing parties, and the other one tells you to stay away. It's very easy. One tells you go to AA meetings in the church, and the other one tells you to stay away. One tells you I'm going to bring the number one Catholic priest missionary to the actual Kilat to give him chizuk on Shabbat, like our dear friend Goldberg from Florida, who wanted to bring a missionary. And another one is going to say, listen, this is a su. It's not allowed. Yeah, but people are going to hate you because you're not politically correct. Okay, so let them hate me. It's very easy to tell the difference. You just have to pay attention. Now, there was one time a big irua in Eretz Yisrael. All of the chachamim, all of the people that are important in the Torah world were getting together. One of the gedolei ador was coming, and the rashi yeshivot were coming. And one guy that was a Rosh Yeshiva that was known to be extra strict, HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted to give him a personal shiur. So he arrived a little late, you know, like 5 minutes after they closed the door. And he wants to go inside. And he says, listen, I'm Rosh Yeshiva, I helped arrange the event, I have this. And the guy says, no problem, you have a ticket? No, I don't have a ticket. So I'm sorry, I can't let you in. He goes, what do you mean? But I'm this, but I'm that, and that. I'm sorry. He goes, yeah, but my son is with me. He says, "Your son, you're not son. I can't help you." And he's arguing with the guy for an hour and a half, trying to get in. And he can't believe that he did so much to get this event together, but he cannot see what's going on inside. After an hour and a half, the gadol that was inside finished speaking and people started running out. One of his friends, another Rosh Yeshiva, saw him. He goes, "Hey, where you been? I didn't see you all night." He goes, "No, come on, I can't believe you." And he gives him every name in the book, every klala, the Barshat, the Hukotai. It goes on this guy, poor guy. "I can't believe you, you guys. You should be ashamed of yourself. You didn't check on me. I've been outside. Huh?" He goes, okay, listen, I understand. You finished? You finished? "No, I'm finished." Okay, listen, the rabbi's still inside. He's waiting till everybody leaves, but he's still inside. So come, I'll give you a personal meeting with him to make up for it. You know, you were outside for an hour and a half after all. Come on, come inside. So he goes inside, and the big rabbi says, "Shalom Aleichem." And the Rosh Yeshiva says, "Yeah, Kvod Rav, how are you?" All of a sudden, everything's okay. And the friend tells him, "Listen, Kvod Rav, it's mamash kaparat avonot. This guy just went through. He's been outside for an hour and a half. He's one of the guys that helped arrange. He did this, he did that. He's a Rosh Yeshiva. He's a Ish Chashuv. He's so important. So he thinks, he said, "Rabbi, why don't you give him chizuk, you know, because it's tough what he went through." So the guy is excited because he wants to hear chizuk from the Gedol Ador. So the Gedol says to him, "Can you tell me a little bit what you felt when you were outside?" He says, "Well, Kvod Rav, it felt terrible." No, tell me a little bit. "I know terrible, but tell me more. How did it feel to be outside?" He says, "Well, honestly, Kvod Rav, I think I don't have to go to Gehinnom. That's how bad it was. So bad to be outside. It was mamash like Gehinnom." Because tell me more. How does it feel to be in Gehinnom? "Kvod Rav, it's really terrible. I felt alone. I felt miserable. I felt like no one cares. I felt like this. I felt like that." And he starts going into 5 minutes of describing it. And the Gedol Ador says to him, "Now let me ask you a question. How many people did you reject this year in your yeshiva when they applied? But they were Sfaradim instead of Ashkenazim. They were Ashkenazim instead of Sfaradim. They were from this Chabad or that Chabad or this Keila or that Keila. How many of them did you reject this year?" He says, "Many." He says, "So maybe they feel the same way you did. Did you ever think that they also feel that after you reject them, they're alone and no one loves them and no one accepts them, and even though they're trying, but just because their grandfather came from the desert and your grandfather came from some country in Europe, that's enough of a reason to reject them? Or maybe because they don't pronounce the word the way you do, and maybe because of they don't have enough money or they don't have enough this, but you decided, no, they don't belong among the rest of us. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave you a tikkun in this world. You should say thank you." Rabotai Yekarim, the sinat chinam doesn't just come from the Sephardi guy doesn't like the Ashkenazi guy doesn't like the Sephardi guy, the Yemenite doesn't like anyone because no one knows how to speak. No, it's not just that. It's even among each other. Chazal tells in the Gemara that even if you have one keilah, one minyan of people that actually have achdut, actually have a common goal, actually do not have a machloket, they simply come, they pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The overall mission of the keilah is the same. 10 people, Mashiach comes on the spot. 10 people in the entire world, doesn't say in Eretz Yisrael, anywhere in the world. Now, on one hand, this should encourage us. We should get 10 people. On another hand, it's very discouraging that we haven't been able to succeed for 2,000 years. So when it comes to the Torah and mitzvot, it's not necessarily just learning the Shas by heart, or the Gemara, or the this one, or the that. It's not just about that. It's learning how to apply these things to your life, and understanding that when HaKadosh Baruch Hu says something, he's not joking. He's serious. You may not take him seriously, but for sure he's serious. When he said that someone that gets in the way of Torah to stop a shiur, to go against the rabbi, to go against the real Torah because his way is different, he should know that you got in the way of the Torah. In Shemaim, they call that person Arur, the worst curse in the Torah. So much so that the rest of Am Yisrael says Amen. Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, Moshe, Aaron, David, Shlomo, all of them say Amen. To what? To cursing this person that got in the way of the Torah. Why would anybody want such a horrible curse? Why? Because you don't like the way he speaks? Or you don't like the way his hat looks? Or you don't like the way, whether he has a beard or he doesn't have a beard? The question is, does he teach Torah or not? Is it true or is it fake? If HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't want people to know it, he wouldn't write it in a Chumash. If he wrote in a Chumash that a Mechalel Shabbat is Mot Yumat, that's what he means. He's not trying to sugarcoat it. If HaKadosh Baruch Hu wrote that somebody that goes against the Shem in different ways has a punishment, that means he wants you to know it. So if somebody's teaching about the parts of the Torah that are not so pleasing to hear about, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu decided to write in the Torah, you going against him is not going against the person, it's going against Hashem. You going against people that are teaching Torah is not going against, it's going against Hashem. Now, of course, nobody here thinks that they're going against Hashem, because everybody, Baruch Hashem, hears to listen to Torah. So how is it that still we don't have Mashiach, even though we have, Baruch Hashem, a few hundred people here that all want Mashiach to come, that all want all of Am Yisrael to do tshuva? Apparently we're not doing enough. Apparently we're not doing enough, Rabotai. Whatever we're doing, it's not enough. How do I know? Two reasons. Number one, salvation hasn't come yet. If it was enough, it would have come. Two, almost 90% of Am Yisrael is still Mechalel Shabbat. Almost 90% of Am Yisrael does not even fulfill the basic mitzvah that makes you a Jew. And probably a higher percentage do not even know the meaning of what Yirat Shamayim means. What being afraid of a Kadosh Baruch Hu means. So that means that it's our job to do something about it. Now, Rabbi Yonatan Eibishitz, Alav Shalom, said that Sinat Chinam is not just about talking about a different keilah and you don't like him, or you don't this, or you don't that. Sinat Chinam is when you see another Jew sinning, you see him drive on Shabbat, but you don't say anything. Why? Ah, maybe it's going to turn him off. Yeah, but he's off already. He's off the road, he's driving on Shabbat. How much off can you get? Him and the guy that's buying a Buddha statue are the same thing. What's the difference? No, but maybe I could get him to Judaism by showing him love. What? By complimenting him going against the Kadosh Baruch Hu? So someone went to a gas station one time after his car broke down. He had a tank. He just walked in the desert for 3.5 hours. Don't try this at home. The guy comes with the tank and he says, I need some gas. The guy happily comes, hey, listen, fill up the whole thing. He goes, well, on second thought, I'm sorry, I'm not interested. Is it something that I said? He goes, no, you didn't say it, but I'm not interested. He goes, well, the gas here is good. He goes, the gas is good, fine. I'm not interested. Where's the next gas station? Because the next gas station is 10 miles away. He goes, okay, so I'll walk there. He says, what's wrong with our gas? He goes, it's not the gas. I just don't want to buy gas here. I'm going to go over there. He goes, yeah, but it's the desert. You're going to walk 10 miles in the desert? He said, yes. Why? He said, you're not going to understand. He goes, listen, maybe you have a beard and a kippah and I don't, but I'm not stupid. Tell me what? What's the problem? You're not going to understand. No, no, tell me. Tell me, no, come on. Okay, I'll tell you. Let's say somebody decides to go get a billboard in New York, $250,000 a month. And instead of putting CNBC's next show, he puts all types of curses against your father. He says, your father's this, your father's that, your father's this, your father's that, all types of things against your father. Are you going to do business with him? He goes, what business with him? Where does he live? I'll find him right now. He goes, okay, sir, that's my point. He says, what are you talking about? I don't even know your father. He goes, maybe you don't think you know my father, but you have a sign over here that says that you do business 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That means that you are not only violating Shabbat, but you're advertising it to the public that you are going against my father in heaven and you want me to do business with you. Rabotai Yekarim, it's very easy to give everybody a compliment. All of the rich people and all of the this people and all of the that people. But Arav Wasserman, Alav HaShalom, wrote in one of his answers in a letter that if you are complimenting the wicked, you're wicked too. His makor was not only Sha'arei Tshuva, but also Shlomo HaMelech himself. The point is, Rabotai, is that it's not about trying to bring people closer by complimenting them. You have to bring people closer by telling them what HaKadosh Baruch Hu said. How they decide what they're going to do once they have that information, that's not your business. It's not your business whether they're turned on or turned off or turned neutral or maybe they're going to revert. It doesn't matter. It's not your business. Your business is to simply deliver the Torah to them on a silver platter. Now, if they're really close to you, I recommend you don't tell them one thing. Don't talk. Why? You'll ruin it. What do? You let us talk. You give them a CD. You give them a link. Why? If they know you, they're not going to listen to you. If they're your father, they're your mother, they're your brother, they're your sister, they're your workmate, they're not going to listen to you. Why? They know you since you were like in diapers. How are they going to listen to you now? Why? Because you have a beard now? Okay, so you're a beard with diapers. They know you from a long time. They know you when you used to go out with the Goya. They know you when you used to go to the bars. They know you when you used to be a promoter in clubs, Hashem Yirachem on those people. They know you when you used to sell clothes to women that weren't exactly Bat Israel. They know you had the store for those women. They work in those places. Well, you made a lot of money. They know you since then, before the beard. The beard comes for free. That's why the goat has it too. But the point is, Rabotai, they know. So they're not going to listen to you. So what are they going to do? They're going to listen to a stranger. Why? That's the only version of them that they know. So you give them a CD. You give them a link. You press share. Right or left finger, same price. The point is, you try to be a mezakeh rabbi. Try to help the public by bringing them the truth. Not your version of the truth. Not what you think is too hard or too weak or too this or too that. Just the truth. Uncensored truth. What did Hashem say? Share. That's it. Nothing else. If you have more than just a finger, you work for a living, you make a few shekels above your bills, which is rare in this day, but you actually do, you could actually use money too for that, not just to buy stock, believe it or not. Money is not just for buying stocks. You can actually do other stuff with it. It's not even buying houses too. You could do other stuff with it, like Kiruv, like helping Am Yisrael do tshuva. The point is, Rabotai, is that you could all become little messengers of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. By simply taking a little bit of time of your day to publicize Torah. Now, the Mishnah in Avot says that kol mezakeh et harabim en chet ba'al yado. Someone that encourages the public to get closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu has special treatment of this person when it comes to giving them different tests. He also says to the prophet Jeremiah, Im totzia kal mizolel kepitiye, if you bring somebody that used to be a criminal, somebody used to drive on Shabbat, somebody that used to be Hashem Yerachem, all types of other sins, and you get this person close to Hashem, you get him to start praying every day, put on tefillin, listen to Torah, learn Torah, real tshuva, not fake tshuva like he did a few mitzvot, but he's still going out with a goya. Real tshuva. He changed his life. Not that he's going to pray all day, but that he goes to clubs on weekends. Somebody that changed his life. Somebody that's an Eved Hashem, not the fakers. There's plenty of those. They put on tefillin and before the pork sandwich. No, Rabbi, it wasn't pork. Where was it? Where'd you get it from? It was Subway tuna sandwich. Oh, Subway's kosher now? Well, no, not really. Okay, so it's pork. What do you mean? Well, the bread. You know what's in the bread? Oh, I didn't check. It's pork. Yeah, but it's a tuna sandwich. Yeah, the tuna is fine. The tuna's a fish until they put pork on it. Yeah, but it's salad only. Okay, so the salad is worse than pork. Why? It has worms. She said shakol. Not bore pri adama. All the worms that are on it. So there's plenty of those. But those people, they give tzedakah, they put on tefillin, they come for minyan once in a while. There's plenty of people doing mitzvot. We don't need people doing mitzvot only. We need people doing tshuva. Tshuva means change your life, change your ideology. Put the screw that's missing back in. That's what tshuva means. Change your life. Now changing your life takes time. But it takes a second to decide. 1 second to decide. Am I going to change my life or no? Am I going to try my best to do what Hashem wants or no? 1 second. The process could take years. But 1 second decision. Each person could be that button. That button that causes the person to change their ways. That's what you can do. In a million different ways. For free, for money, for efforts, for skills. Plenty of different ways. Plenty of different ways to do it. Each person can do it. But in order to do such a thing, you have to understand what's it going to take. Well, first we need to know the reward. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, if you do it and you get people to do tshuva, you're going to be like my mouth. Kepitiye. If you bring the criminal and you make him something precious, you make him a Baal tshuva, you're going to be like my mouth. What does it mean to be like Hashem's mouth? To be like Hashem's mouth means you pray, Hashem says, check. You ask for something, Hashem says, no problem. You need something, check. Why? That's how we live. All three of our lives are living miracles. I don't know the financial situation of everybody. All I know is that it has to be a miracle. Why? We're here. We're all supposed to be in businesses, running a bank, running a company, running this, running that. But no, we're doing this. For what? For free. For free. How? How do you pay for the mortgage? How do you pay for the rent? How do you pay for the car? How do you pay for $52? For heaven's sake, gas just to get here. I don't know. Hashem sent it. What? Did you fill in some clock somewhere? No. Did you collect? Did you do something? You charged for a lecture yesterday? No. So how did you do it? I don't know, Hashem paid. Hashem paid. There's plenty of people that charge for lectures. But that's also why they don't necessarily tell you the same thing. Why? Because if you pay, you could also make the decision of what they say. So you see, Rabotai Kareem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, if you help people do tshuva, You ask for something, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is simply going to fulfill it. You don't need to be a speaker. All you need is to have ratzon. Just the will to help other Jews do tshuva. That's all you need. But in order to do that, in order to have success at doing kiruv, at helping Am Yisrael do tshuva, you cannot just have willpower by simply exercising your arms by giving CDs away. You cannot have willpower just by pressing the button on the internet for your PayPal to press, yeah, send money, send money, send money. That's not enough. You have to have merit. You have to have merit, meaning HaKadosh Baruch Hu needs to want your kiruv. And the only way to get that is with Torah. Is by learning and fulfilling the Torah yourself. You cannot be a kofer with a nightclub and expect to help people do tshuva. How do I know? Experience. I had a guy come to a shiur one time. After the shiur, I never saw this guy before. After the shiur, he says, can I talk to you for a second? I said, no problem. I was doing the lectures at my house at the time. We go into my office in the house. And he looks, I have a whiteboard with all types of numbers on it and different plans, you know, like some math formula. It just means money, though. That's what I need to do what I want and so on and so forth. But there's, at the end over there, it's like, how much am I missing? Total. 100%, 99%, 98%. That's how much is missing. But then you have the goal, though, so you have the ambition. So the guy says, oh, so this is what you want to do, this is what you want to do. This is what I said, yes. He goes, well, I can help. I said, okay, fine, welcome. Welcome, Baruch Haba. He goes, okay, I'm going to look at the numbers, and I'll get back to you. I said, no problem. So after he left, I didn't ask him what he does. I care less what he does. The guy says he wants to help. Baruch Haba, doesn't want to help. But it's, money doesn't fascinate me simply because it doesn't move me because I was in the business of money. So you could tell me a million, take me 100 million, it's all the same to me. You're not going to impress me. So the guy says he wants to help. Baruch Haba, don't want to help. Baruch Haba. Honestly, I should have given just $10, would have been better off. $100 even more. The help on next week, who knows what's going to happen between now and next week. So I said, Baruch Haba, call the numbers, do the numbers, whatever you want, no problem. Anyway, Rabotai, a few days later, a week later, I had another lecture, I see the same guy again. And this time he brought his partner. Both him and his partner were impressed. I for a second, I thought I was Mashiach. How much they were impressed by me. Oh, who, ha, he, he. Oh, good. Okay, I'm not really that good, but fine, no problem. So did you look at the numbers? Yeah, that's why I brought the part. We're looking at the numbers, and for sure, guess what? Korach ve'adato, the ground swallowed him. I think they took this guy too. Why? I could never see it, never saw the guy ever again. Mamash, ground swallowed him, disappeared from the face of the earth. So one day, one of the people comes to me and says, you know that guy that keeps coming to you? I said, yeah. He goes, you know, that guy's worth at least $100 million. I said, great, so? He goes, isn't that impressive? I said, no, not really, not particularly, no. It's a lot of money. I'm like, good for him. What does he do with it? He says, well, he has nightclubs. I said, now I understand why HaKadosh Baruch Hu swallowed them up. Why? It's impossible to be a Machtiya Rabim and a Mizakeya Rabim at the same time. There is no way in the world that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to allow someone that causes people to sin also to help them do tshuva. Why? You cause 25,000 to sin every night by going to your nightclub, but at the same time you think he's going to allow you to actually do real tshuva and get other people to do tshuva? What do you think Hashem is? What do you think of Hashem? Meaning, Rabotai Karim, it's not just about doing something kosher as far as helping other people. It's also being kosher ourselves. We have to rebuke ourselves. We have to work on ourselves. We have to look in the mirror and see ourselves instead of everything behind us. So, if you want the blessing that could literally give you anything and everything you ever need, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, available. But there are certain requirements. There are certain things that are needed. It's not so hard. All it requires is the willpower and effort to do tshuva yourself and to help other people. This, Rabotai Yekarim, is my message today to myself. Hopefully you learned from something from it as well. Be'ezrat Hashem na'aseh v'natzliach. Bechavod kvod Rav Mizrachi. From the mouth of the speakers, what they have to say. What is the difference? Lichora, you should say, what's the difference? Here I heard 3 hours on Facebook, or tomorrow on YouTube, and here I have 3 hours live. What is the difference? The Chafetz Chaim say, every hour it's 60,000 mitzvot. 3 hours, 180,000 mitzvot. Whether I'm sitting here in Bet El, synagogue, or whether I'm sitting anywhere else in the world watching it live, 180,000 mitzvot. The answer, in your dreams. And I'll tell you why. Why in your dreams? Because we have a rule, and the Gemara speaks about it in Masechet Baba Batra, to explain the concept. The concept is that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted the nation of Israel to help each other, to live in unity and to have a brotherhood, and everyone should push each other to do mitzvot. So he created a very interesting multi-level marketing system, but a spiritual one. Meaning if you start, everyone that comes after you benefits you as well, and those who come under them benefits everyone on the top. Everyone benefits everybody else, as long as they had a share in the mitzvah. So the Gemara says, Gadol ha-me'aseh yoter min ha-oseh. If you make other people do something positive, your reward is even greater than them. Meaning, whatever reward Hashem is going to give them, you are going to get a little bit more than them doing nothing. Just encouraging them to do the mitzvah. Come, put tefillin. He's going to sit now 5 minutes, say Shema Yisrael. He did nothing. He said a few words. You get more than him. Now, when you make an event, if nobody comes, the speaker has nobody to talk to. There's not going to be a lecture. If everyone would sit home on a screen, waiting for the lectures to start, no one would come. So everyone who physically come to lectures, even though it's broadcast live at home, he becomes a partner to creating the lecture. And since now there are many, many thousands of people watching live, everybody that sits here earns millions of mitzvot every minute. And then later it's going to be on Facebook and on CDs and on DVDs, and maybe some of it will go into the next book. You will get an eternal reward for sitting here and not home. So what you get in the 3 hours, it's a peanut compared to the real profit. Why? Because Hashem wanted to make the world that everyone will be busy doing kiruv and saving souls. And the way to do it is to contribute. And that's why it's called schar alicha. You come to the lecture, you get an extra reward for the efforts to arrive. So that's fantastic. It reminds me that one speaker in Israel, you know, there's all kinds of organizations who call speakers and they pay them for the lecture. It's a common thing. How much you charge? Whatever you charge, okay. So now one speaker came to a place, big place, auditorium. Only one person showed up. Big auditorium, one person sits in the middle. So he said to me, listen, before I start the lecture, I have to give you a great gratitude. You know, I really, really appreciate you. Thanks to you, I'm getting my paycheck tonight. Imagine if you wouldn't show up, they would say to me, I'm sorry, there was no lecture. Who would I talk to? The wall. So at least there is an audience. Thanks to you, I'm going to get paid tonight. So the guy say, by the way, if you can make it quick, because I'm the next speaker after you. Speaking about auditorium, it reminds me of a very big miracle I had about a year ago, or maybe a little more in Israel. I was speaking in an auditorium. It's a college for music. A nice big auditorium, lots of people. At around 11:15 at night, I asked the people a question. Anyone here can tell me why it's better to be a human being and not a cat? Everyone looks at me, where this guy came from? I don't want to be a cat. I started to give them example of some cats that inherit a lot of money, and they get massage and great food and a special doctor, and they take them on trips and they run in the backyard. They have the best life. They don't sit in a 405 in LA 3 hours in traffic every day, working 10 years to pay for the bathroom of their house. They have great life, these cats. As everybody trying to think to convince me why it's better to be a person than not a cat, all of a sudden, I see hundreds of people got up like this in the middle of the lecture. You remember, I sit on the stage, and when everyone gets up and look at the floor, I cannot see what happened. So I was wondering what happened just now. Everyone goes like this. Oh my God, oh my God. A big fat cat walked in from the street. You have it on the video. I know, if you won't see it, you think I make it up. Go and watch it, live. You can see it, I mean not live, you can see the recording. 11:15, just when I speak about the cat, a cat walked from the street, big fat cat sat next to me. I said that probably this lecture is for the neshama in this cat. Showed up. Unbelievable. And then people ask, Rabbi, do you believe there is a God? What are the odds? So before I start my lecture, I relax, it will be short this time. You know, I want to get a lecture from 8 p.m. until 7:30 a.m. in Ocean Parkway, straight. It was sunny when I came out. Bumper to bumper, Ocean Parkway. Sunny, my last day. People waited until the morning, nobody went home. As you can see, I'm holding a very important book that my very dear friend wrote, Rabbi Yamin Golan from the Betting here in Queens. We know each other for years. And the reason I decided to make promotion for this book, which I never do, because it's very important. There's hundreds or maybe thousands of Gentiles that are in the process of trying to convert or, you know, learning about Judaism and begging basically to join the chosen people. Plus, there are many Jews that have no idea about Judaism, and they're starting to keep the first mitzvot in their life, not knowing what to do.
So I had an experience that we had many hundreds of converts over the years in a Beit Din, and he wrote an amazing book that every one of the people who wants to join Judaism and every Jew that needs to learn the basic, it's fantastic for you. And you have it already in different languages already. It came already in a few languages, Spanish and other languages, Russian, other languages as well, Korean. And Bezrat Hashem will be translated to more.
What's the name?
The name of the book is Welcome to Judaism, as you can see right here. And Baruch Hashem, the reason I wanted to promote it is because anyone who would like to sponsor or to help him to bring this book up to the public is right here, or you can get him through me. You can email me and I'll give you the information. People will be able to order in advance that he will be able to finish the job and they get 50% off, because it's our interest that every one of these righteous Gentiles who wants to join the Jewish nation and every Jew who begins to keep the first mitzvot in his life, they will read this book. It comes with colors and pictures and it's fantastic. And the reason that it's important for us, because the Gemara says that one of the reasons that Hashem spread the Jewish people all over the world is to make a lot of converts, to bring the Goyim and make them join the Jewish nation. Lo pizer HaKadosh Baruch Hu et Yisrael ben haumot, ela kedei larbot alehem gerim. To take the righteous Goyim and make them join the Jewish nation. And today, I want to tell you a secret. You don't work with the public, so it would look very strange what I'm telling you, but I can tell you that from experience. It seems to me that in the last 20, 30 years, there is a process in the world that in one hand, many of our brothers and sisters, what we call Jewish people from birth, are giving up on Judaism, not knowing what it is, but they're giving up on it. There's 70% intermarriage, horrible assimilation. Many people basically left the religion by choice. Not that they know what they left, but they did it. They went, they married other people, and they basically left their identity. And on the other hand, since HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't want the chosen nation to disappear, he brings a lot of righteous Gentile who in their past life wanted to accept the Torah, but the majority of the nation where they came from voted against it. That's what the Zohar, the Kabbalah says. That every Gentile wanted to accept the Torah when Hashem offered the Torah to all the nations, they made a vote and the majority said, no, what's in it? We're not sure. But some of these Goyim, they say, we want the Torah. There's nothing, nothing can go wrong. After what Hashem did to the Jewish people, all the miracles of Egypt, the exodus of Egypt, how can we not want to be a part of that nation? But they were the minority. And the Zohar say, no one is neglected by Hashem. Everybody gets what he deserves for good and for bad. And therefore, if some Goy 3,300 years ago wanted to be Jewish, wanted to join the Torah, in the next generation, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will send them in different parts of the world to give them the opportunity to do tshuva and to join the Jewish nation and convert. And some of the greatest rabbis in history came from converts, like Rabbi Akiva and many, Shmayav, Talion, and many others, as we know. And this is a part of our obligation, to be light for the Goyim. Now, I would like to basically continue with something very interesting that we all have challenges and tests, many nisyonot in life. The Gemara in Masechet Megillah, page 15, the words of the Maharsha. Maharsha was one of the important commentaries on the Gemara. He brings the word of the Gemara in Baba Batra, page Nun Zayin, 57. The Gemara say, a person is in his life. It's an intersection. Kasher en derech acheret, when there is no other way, how you define such a situation? You're stuck in a situation now. There is no other way. You're stuck on the road. There's no reverse, no right, no left. You're stuck on the highway. All you have to do is to go straight. There's no other option. That's called anus. You are forced. There's no way out. You are forced to be in this situation. Person was born with no hands. He's forced into a situation that he cannot put tefillin. Will he be punished for that? Or no? What do you think? He was born without hands. Every day he comes to the synagogue, he sees everyone puts tefillin. His heart is breaking. Why? I wish I had a hand for one day that I can put tefillin at least once in my life. Every day eats his heart. And in the end, imagine when he passed, Hashem said, okay, now let's see how many times in your life you did not put tefillin and see what kind of punishment we have to give you. Make sense? Does not make sense. Why? Because he's anus. Anus rachmana patre. You're blind. You cannot read. Nobody's going to hold you responsible. You're poor. You want to give tzedakah. But you don't have. You barely pay your rent. Will Hashem hold you responsible for not giving tzedakah or no? Yes and no. No, I know what you already know the answer for no. But who can tell me the answer for yes? Yes?
Everyone can give one penny.
One penny won't make any one of us do the right thing. The PayPal fees will be 35 cents on that penny. So we'll be bankrupt with one penny donations.
Yeah. Huh? Give your time?
That's very interesting. Give some of your time. But I'm talking real money. That's what he says. Time contribute in different ways. Remember what I said 2 minutes ago? Make other people give. Whatever they give, it will count you gave more. You can be poor, broke, in bankruptcy, barely pay for a sandwich, and you can give more tzedakah than a very rich guy. If you convince your rich uncles and friends and who knows where, to come and help to do good things, everyone who will follow your advice count like you gave. So a poor person in this world can live the world with more tzedakah than a very rich guy. Why? Because he affected others to do. You understand? So now let's see. One way you have, if there's no other way, anusu. If there is another way, then what do you call this person? If there was another way, and he chose the wrong path, what he become?
Rasha.
There's no in between. You are either anus or you rasha. That's what the Gemara said. I'll give you an example. What does it mean, rasha? If we would see now on a candy camera, you know, one of these security camera, a religious guy walks now in a street, somewhere in Queens, Manhattan, I don't know where. And there is two ways to go to his destination. He can go straight, shortcut, or he can go around the park, which is four times more. Instead of 5 minutes, 20 minutes. The problem is that in a shortcut, there's a lot of women sit on chairs with the children on the front, you know, play, but there's a lot of women. So if he's going to cut from the shortcut, he's going to see a lot of girls. Maybe his Yetzer Hara going to get into his head. He's going to start looking, thinking, I made a sin. Or the long way is clean. No one is there. Some forest, trees, you can go around. Safe, but four times more walking. Especially in the sun or in the snow. Now, you see this person took his hat, went like this. Block his view, and turn his face to the left, and quickly walked, cut through the shortcut, and did not look at one of the girls there, not even one of them. And we saw something like this on a candy camera, and now we know where this guy is. We come to the shul, and we see he's praying now. What is the first thing that comes to our mind when we see him praying Shmona Esrei after yesterday we saw him on a candy camera closing his eyes and cutting through the shortcut? What's the first thing you wait until he finished to pray? What's the first thing you want to do? Right away, you want to run to him? Kiss his hand, excuse me, Chacham. Chacham. Please give me bracha. Mwah, mwah. Please, please. Can I drive you? Can I do something for you? Tzaddik like you, wow. Finally, we found tzaddik echad besdom. Give me hilu shederach, avotel rabah. Put your hand on my head. The Gemara say, Rasha. This guy is wicked. I don't know what's going to be with us. Let's calculate. If they're Rasha, what's going to be with us? We can't walk in the street today based on this. Why is Rasha? Because he dared to put himself in a minefield. He got lucky, it did not explode. Today it didn't explode, tomorrow it didn't explode. The third day it will explode and you die. The fact that you put yourself in such a place already shows you do not have enough fear from God. No Yirat Shamayim. Because somebody with Yirat Shamayim will never dare to put himself in a test. Based on that, allow me to understand something here. The Gemara in Sanhedrin Kuf Zayin, the Gemara say, Le'olam al yavi adam atzmo lidei nisayon. Person should not bring himself into a test. She'are David HaMelech, one of the greatest 10 people who lived in the history of the world, David HaMelech, that the Mashiach will come from him. It's enough just to read Tehillim once in your life to understand that a soul like this come once in a lifetime to this world. Such a neshama like David HaMelech, such honesty, such emunah, such confidence, such anava, such everything we can dream about he had. I once gave an example of David HaMelech. How many people praying to Hashem to help their enemies to find them and kill them if they're guilty? When we know the police is chasing us and we're hiding somewhere, we read Tehillim and pray all day, Ribono Shel Olam, save me from this wicked police, this antishemim. Wow, they hate me because I'm a Jew. Please save me from the IRA, save me from the Arab, save me from the neighbor. We never say to Hashem, save me if I'm innocent. And if I'm not, make him find me right away and give me what I deserve. How many people in the world pray like this? Who pray like this, raise his hand. Baruch Hashem, all of you honest. You see what honest people are. Do you ever pray that someone else will succeed on your expense? No, you want to be the first one. You don't want anyone who is after you to find you. It doesn't matter who is right. Even you know you are the thief and he is the policeman. You're still praying to Hashem to save you from this evil Rasha that want to kill me or arrest me. But David HaMelech didn't pray like this. Say, if I'm guilty, make Shaul HaMelech and his soldiers find me quickly and kill me. But if not, save me from them. This is the level of emet he had. Why we have to admire such a person so much? Because the level of his emet was the ultimate emet. The ultimate. It cannot get any higher than that. The emet of David HaMelech. David HaMelech had a test. One time in his life he put himself in a test. The Gemara said, not me. The Gemara didn't say it. Who can open out his mouth? The Gemara said, a person should not put himself in a test. Sha'are David HaMelech hivya atzmo lidei nisayon v'nichshal. David HaMelech put himself in a test and failed. But we have a question. David HaMelech had only one test in his life. I can name to you 1,000 tests that I learned in my life about his life. Shaul, his son, his other son, Amnon and Tamar, so many problems. His father threw him away and said, listen, you may be not my son, go take care of the sheep, don't be around too much. Everyone called him Mamzer, poor, isolated. Such a horrible life he had. That's why in Tehillim, what we read in the Halel, he said, Ani avdecha ben amatecha. He doesn't say, Ani avdecha ben avdecha. His father was Ishai, the biggest tzaddik in the world. One of the four biggest tzaddikim lived in a history who never made one sin in his life. That's his father. And instead of giving the credit, I am the son of the biggest tzaddik in the world, and one of the biggest in the history, who does he give the credit to? To a housewife. His mother that washed the dishes and go do laundry by the lake. How is it possible? If your son is gdol ador and your mother is working in a kitchen making eggplant salad, you come and say, who are you? Moshe ben Miriam. Who is Miriam? Miriam, the one that working in a laundry mat. Excuse me, you're not, by the way, the son of Rav Eliashiv or Rav Sternbuch or Rav Kanievsky. Yeah, yes, my father. So why don't you say that you're his father, his son? What's the comparison? The answer is gratitude. Gratitude is the most important thing in the life of a Jew. That's why if somebody asks you to say, define in one word what Judaism is all about. One word. The word is modeh. That's it. Four letters. Modeh means in Hebrew. Modeh meaning thank you. Ani modeh lecha, I thank you. Modeh means emet, I admit. I admit and I have gratitude. That's what Judaism is all about. Pay attention. Mitzvot, levarech, brachot, bracha before, bracha after. Everything, thank you Hashem. We appreciate praising Hashem. Tfilat Shmona Esrei. Everything is requesting, gratitude, admitting, and what the Gemara say? Mor mechase peshaav lo yatzliach. Someone who try to cover his sin will never succeed. Just a matter of time until Hashem will reveal it. Umodeh ve'ozev yerucham. If you admit and stop with the sin, then you get mercy. Meaning, as long as you're stubborn and full of ego, I'm good, I'm tzaddik, I did nothing wrong, I have nothing to apologize about, the American way, you know. I'm perfect, who, you know, why you criticize, don't be judgmental. I made a lecture 2 weeks ago, the obligation of being judgmental every minute of your life. It sounds tricky until you listen. The Torah says you have to judge the situation. Someone rasha comes to your house, goes into your bedroom. What's the first thing you have to assume? He's looking for your wife's diamonds. Ah, it's not fair. Why you suspect him? The Gemara says, every person in one hand, you look at him like he's Rabban Gamliel. On the other hand, you have to look at him like he's a robber. Came to rob my life. You have to be careful. There's no mitzvah to be stupid. Some people were stupid and a big destruction came later on. There's no mitzvah in Judaism to be stupid. It's mitzvah to give benefits of the doubt to those who have cheskat kasher in this specific matter. But you're not supposed to give cheskat kasher to someone who's known as a big rasha. The whole world knows he's a murderer. He's the first suspect. That's what the Torah says. You have to learn the halachot. Many people scream all kinds of statements. It makes my ear fall when I hear their nonsense. Sometimes even famous people. The basic foundations they don't have. Right away they shoot statement. Who told you that? It's not true. Sometimes they make the entire hour lecture on something that to begin with is wrong. A whole 1 hour is waste of time and misleading the public. We have to know that, Rabotai. Not everything is feelings. The Torah is brain, is sechel. The Torah says who you should have mercy on and who you're not allowed to have mercy on. And what happens if you mix? If you have mercy on people that Hashem himself doesn't have mercy on, and he said that you don't, not supposed to have mercy on these kind of people, you know what's going to be the consequences of that? That when you need to have a mercy on a big tzaddik, then you're going to go and stab him in the back. Why? Because you wasted your mercy on the wrong people. Just like in Israel. Half of the Israelis have mercies on who? On the Hamas Palestinian filthy murderers. And who they hate the most? The Talmidei Yeshiva, that thanks to them the world exists. You ask them, Yitzik, come, tell me, I want to ask you a question. Who do you love more? Ahmed? Look at Ahmed from Gaza with the donkey. And look at Yitzhak with the Gemara like this. Who do you want to get rid of? What do you think would be the answer? You can ask Rabbi Anava after the lecture. He's from Israel, he'll tell you. That's what's going on. The Gemara say, the hatred, the amei haratzot, has for the Talmidei Chachamim is the highest level of hate. They hate the Talmidei Chachamim, those who thanks to them they are alive, more than anything you can imagine. That's reality. It's a fact. Very sad fact. I wish I wouldn't have to say that, but it's reality. And that's what it's about today. Today it's a struggle, it's a war. It's a cultural war in Israel. Everything you hear, election, this, that, politics, behind the politics, there is ideology here. Behind this whole politics is ideology. If we're going to have yeshivot or chas v'shalom, we'll have to close them. If we're going to be able to open the mikveh when we need or not. If the people that sits and learn Torah will be able to continue to learn Torah 4 more years, or they're going to have to go to the army. That's really what it's about. Behind that policy, behind that politics, we have a Jewish ideology behind it. What do you think? Why the biggest rabbi in the world got involved in politics? That's the last thing they want to waste their time on. Because it's not politics, it's a fight if we're going to be able to keep the Torah and the mitzvot, or chas v'shalom, Israel will become London. That's what it is. That's what the fight is all about. So I started to give an example here with David HaMelech. I can give you thousands of tests that he had in his life. Many of them. Why the Gemara say, David HaMelech put himself in one test and failed? We said before, when there's no other way, you are anus. When you are anus, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is with you in a sin, or he left you when you commit the sin? You're committing a sin right now, but you are anus. You're in a situation that there's no way out. You try, you're begging, you're crying, you're looking for a way out, but you're stuck in that situation. So the question is, when you are in a sin or in a filthy place, or they locked you in a place of Avodah Zarah, you're not supposed to be there. Every second you're there, it's a sin. But the Goyim locked you there. What are you going to do? So HaKadosh Baruch Hu is with you or no? It's written that HaKadosh Baruch Hu shochen im Am Yisrael betoch tumotam. In the filthiest place, Hashem is with us. The filthiest place, without going into details. But on the other hand, it's written, v'ra'a b'cha irvat davar v'shav ma'achareha. If I see that you behave not properly and not modestly, or you do not dress properly, meaning women, or the men do not behave modestly, immediately I run away from that place because I'm holy and I cannot be in such a field. So which one is the truth? What's going on? So like this, Rabotai. כשאין דרך אחרת, and there's no other way, השכינה אינה עוזבת אותו. Hashem is with you holding your hand. But when there is another way, immediately Hashem leaves you. השכינה אינה מתלווה אליו. You have two ways. You chose the dangerous way. Immediately Hashem left you. No siyata dishmaya and no supervision. If you are forced, I will save you, I will protect you, I will help you to overcome the situation. And the Gemara say, בכל יום מצרו של אדם מתגבר עליו ומבקש להמיתו. Every day the Satan is trying to put you down and kill you. Not physically. Physically it's not in his hand. He can only kill you when Hashem will send him the message. But every day he's trying to kill your neshama. Gadol ha-machtiyo yoter min ha-orgo. If he kills your neshama, it's for eternity. Ve'il male ha-kadosh baruch hu osro, eno yachol lo. And if Hashem would not help, there is no chance to overcome the evil inclination and the Satan. So how can it be, if Hashem left me, how is it my chance to overcome the nisayon? The answer is, once you enter there, you're finished. The idea in life is not to put yourself in the test. If the test was forced on you, don't worry, you are nus. Hashem is with you. Everything is supervised. So now we have a new understanding in the words of the Gemara. Person should not bring himself into Nisayon, just like David HaMelech one time asked Hashem, test me. David HaMelech said to Hashem, I want to be the fourth wheel in your carriage. You have Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. I want to be the fourth one. You have one missing. One wheel. Make me the one. Hashem said, no. You're not in that level yet. What do I have to do to be in this level? They had very serious test and they survived, and you did not have a serious test and survive. So what did he say? So put me in a test. Not supposed to. What do we say every morning in a tefillah? I'm begging you, don't give me tests. Please, I'm good the way I am. Don't give me any tests. I give up. I know who I am. I know myself. Person knows himself the best. Person live in denial, like Rabbi Alon said, we all live in denial, some more, some less. But in reality, nobody knows you more than yourself and Hashem, of course. I'll give you a proof. One person was on a trial for murder. Trial for murder. The jury in America, they're about to rule in his case, guilty or not guilty. Just before, it was already a done deal. Everybody saw that this guy is a filthy murderer. That's it. Everybody understand that. The audience, the jury, the judge. A minute before they conclude the closing statement, the lawyer of the defendant, he got up and he said to the jury, ladies and gentlemen, before we conclude this trial, I have a very important message to give you now. Everyone got nervous. What? In exactly 10 minutes, the real murderer will walk here through the door and all of you will have the shame of your life. When you see that you were about to send to a dead wall an innocent man. Your Honor, 10 minutes, please. I'm asking for a break for 10 minutes. Everybody's net. What? Yes? Just wait 10 minutes and you see. 10 minutes, everyone is talking, lots of noise. 9, 9 and a half, 9:55, 58, 59. 10 minutes. Everybody looks at the door. What do you think happened? Huh? A cat walking. <Good luck. laughs> Who walked in? No one. The lawyer got up and he said the law in America says that you cannot convict a person unless you have reason, you cannot release a person unless you have a reasonable doubt. If you have a reasonable doubt, how are you about to convict a person? All of you looked at the door for 10 minutes, which shows that you are not 100% sure that he's a murderer. You want him to be executed when you have such a doubt? Psh, what the knockout he gave them. The judge say, a break, everyone to my room. Sit now for hours and make a decision. After a few hours, they came out. The lady came with a note. Did the jury reach the verdict? Yes, Your Honor. What is the verdict? No. If you're the jury, what would you do? She said, we found the defendant guilty. Everyone was shocked. Guilty after all this shock? He just proved to you, all of you are not sure. They say the truth is that all of us were convinced by the lawyer words. And we're about to dismiss him and send him free. But there was one woman over here who did not give up and convinced all of us that he's guilty. Why? She said, when everybody looked at the door, I did not take my eyes out of his face. I looked at him nonstop, and he's the only person in the courtroom who did not look at the door even one time. Because he knows he's the murderer. If he was innocent, he was waiting for the Mashiach there. You got it, Rabotai? We know who we are. You can put a show here, the world is a stage, everyone is an actor, we know this. The question is how we get out of there. And since we don't have the whole night and time is about to finish, I just want to conclude. This is what it's written. Gam ki elech begeitz al mavet, lo ira ra. I'm in a worse place. I'm not worried. I'm not afraid. Ki ata imadi, because you are with me. Why? Because I did not choose that path. It was false on me. That's why I'm not worried. But when I chose it, I'm very worried. If I chose to go to the club of Manhattan tonight and hope I'm not going to marry Christine tomorrow, there's no guarantee. But if it was false on me, I'm counting on you to help me because it wasn't my choice. So it's all about choices. That's what it's all about. This is a very important principle, Rabotai. Very important. Most of the people are not aware of this. That there are two different kinds of tests. There are tests that we bring on ourselves. You go to the casino and you lose money. Oh, okay, listen. It says that mezunotav shel adam tzuvim lo mirosh hashanah ad rosh hashanah. So whatever I'm supposed to get, a house, food, car, children tuition, I'm going to get anyway. So what if I lost in a casino? No, my friend. Hashem already gave you what you need for this year. You decided to go and burn the money. It's a problem. But sometimes a person can force Hashem to do something that he doesn't want. Literally force Hashem to do something he doesn't want. If a person go and open a business that is shady, it's not a kosher business. He has 7 children to feed. He has a wife. She's a righteous woman. Now Hashem is thinking, what is going to happen now? If I'm making bankrupt, these children will be on the street. There are going to be consequences. This low life is forcing me to give him money through this dirty business. And I have no choice. He put me in that position. This is what Hashem said to a person. You made me a lot. You brought me a lot of bothering. You bothered me a lot. I had to take care of you before you came out to the world. And since you were a baby. And to do so many things to you. And give you so many things. And what do? You take it from me. Never say thank you. And use it against me. And I am forced to continue to give you more, knowing you use it against me tomorrow also. Because I had to give you 80 years of life. That's the test of your life. So I have to give you tomorrow more oxygen, knowing you're going to get me angry again. More money, knowing you're going to drive in Shabbat and put gas in your car and drive to your picnics. I'm giving it to you, and you use it against me. And never say thank you. So this is what it means, Rabotai. בדרך שאדם רוצה ללך מוליכים אותו. You choose the path. No one chooses it for you. That's what you chose. You made me your partner in everything you do. I'd rather be your partner when you learn Torah, when you do mitzvot, when you do kiruv, when you give money to the poor people, when you support yeshivot. For that, I'm very happy that you make me your partner. I give you oxygen for a good cause. I give you money for a good cause. I gave you a brain for a good cause. I'm happy what you do with the gifts that I gave you. But when you use it against me, I see that I am a partner to a crime against me and against the truth. Why is Hashem is the partner? Because that's the rules of the creation. I give you oxygen for X amount of time, even when you make sins. I don't force you to make mitzvot. I don't kill you when you made a sin. If that's the way it was, then every person who make a sin will die right away. After one Chilul Shabbat, everybody will be dead. How many people would be left in the world? 2 minyanim, maybe. So why Hashem gives Mechalel Shabbat millions of dollars and success and is the Prime Minister of Israel or a judge in a Supreme Court and everybody bowed down to this Rasha? Why is it? Because if everyone would light a cigarette on Shabbat, it will explode in his face and he'll die. Not one person will ever break Shabbat. But nobody deserves a reward. With a gun to the head, even Arafat would keep Shabbat. With a gun to the head. You want him to get a reward for it? That's not a way to become religious, with a gun to the head. The idea is he will eliminate the free choice completely. Completely eliminating the free choice. So Hashem says, I'm giving you, I'm helping you, but at the same time, everybody will be judged. Et hakol yavi Hashem b'mishpat. Ayin ro'a, ואוזן שומעת וכל מעשיך בספר נכתבים. You are recorded by video. You are recorded by audio. And everything will be analyzed word by word every second of your life. One person came to the Rebbe Mikotsk and he said to him, Rebbe, you are the religious people are too fanatic. I'm also traditional. But you're too much, I can't. I try to be Baal Tshuva, but believe me, I ran away. Why you ran away, Itzik? I'll tell you why. Everywhere I go, the religious people, en od milvado, there's no one but Hashem. Shiviti Hashem lenigdi tamid. Hashem is in front of my eyes every second of my life. I cannot live with such intimidation. It's intimidating. What is this? Am I walking around with a video camera around me, recording me? I'd rather die. By the way, do you really believe yourself that you say enot milvado, shiviti Hashem lenegdi tamid? You really believe that a person can think only about Hashem all his life? Do you really believe? No. I want you to prove it to me. The Rebbe said, no problem. He took 2 big Hasidim, take him to the lake. They grabbed him, they took him to the lake. The Rebbe came over there, and well, it goes like this, like by the mafia. Like this, with a finger. The 2 Hasidim grab his head, right, drowned him in the water. Ah, he's fighting, put him inside for 30 seconds. The Rebbe goes up, he comes up. The Rebbe goes down, push him down again. Up, down, up, down, 20 minutes. Every time he comes up, push him down again. After 20 minutes, the Rebbe said, finito. Took him a minute or 2 to breathe. What is this? You ask a question, you got your answer. What's the connection? What's the connection? I'll tell you what's the connection. When you were under the water, what is the only thing you thought about? Air, right? When you're down, did you think about your business? Did you think about your beautiful wife? Did you think about the new car you bought yesterday? Did you think about the watch you ordered from Amazon? The new tie? The new suit? Nothing. There's only one thing you thought about. Air. This is what Hashem for us, air. We can't breathe a second without Him. We thank Him for every breath we take. This is what it means. Shiviti Hashem lenigdi tamid. I would like to finish, and then we have a panel of questions and answers. You can ask all 3 of us any question you want about what we spoke about, what we didn't speak about. We'll be more than happy to answer. And then we will have some pictures, and we'll have tefillat arvit. And Bezrat Hashem will conclude this beautiful night. Last thing for tonight. You know, we have an addiction. The name of the addiction is 10-10 news. Not necessarily 10-10 news, because over there you only hear commercials. I'm talking about the person is connected to the news like it's Torah mi Sinai. Every second, president this, president that, this say that, Bibi say that, Iran say that. Constantly push fear into our head, everybody in panic. That's called news. In Shamayim, in heaven, they also have news. In Israel, every hour, since I was a baby, they have an interesting custom. Every round hour, news. Toot, 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 toot. Only the toot gives you a heart attack already. Like 10 times. Toot, toot. Here is the news of today. Every hour repeats. In Shamayim, they also announce the news. Who can tell me what is the difference between the news in this world to the news in the spiritual world? There's one main difference. Who knows? Over here, 99% of the news is fake news. We all know that. Over there, it has to be real. It's the world of the emet. But there is one main principle that is the difference. Over here, the entire news is speaking about what? What Hashem does. Earthquake here, a war over there, financial collapse over here, Wall Street collapse over there. Everything they announce, it's all the hands of Hashem. They're not admitting it. They call it nature, they call it all kinds of names. But everything you hear on the news, whatever happened in the world, it's all Hashem. Moving the soldiers on the game. Over there, the news is the exact opposite. It's what the people do. That's the difference. Over there, there is a special news for every one of us. What Moshe did today. What Yitzchak did today. And in the end of the day, when you go to sleep, they take your soul. They bring you into the report of the day, sign over here. That's it. That's what we say in the morning, Neshama shenatata bi, he give me back my soul. Why? Because my soul was up there signing on what I did today. That's it. Even though there is a news of every one of us, there's also a general news channel that talks about unique people in the world. Who do you think are the stars of the divine news channel of Hashem? The Talmidei Chachamim, the Tzadikim, Gdolei Ador, Rabbanim, Mekarvim. Okay. But there are three more people that Hashem announced on them every day. Three people. The first one, by the way, this was written 2,000 years ago. Today, multiply it by a million. This was relevant 2,000 years ago, when every woman was covered from head to toe, and there was no problems like today we have, and no social media, and no nisyonot like today in the world. The way the world 2,000 years ago to today is nothing to compare. Three people Hashem announced. One, a single guy that lives in a big city and does not make scenes with the girls. Rabbi Amban, Shuvah 3 years. I didn't touch a woman for 3 years. I'm going crazy anymore. What does Hashem want from me? I want to get married. But he doesn't break. What's with you, Itzik? You alone? Why don't you come for a cup of coffee? He doesn't put himself in this or not. He knows his limitation. No, no, I have to go. I'm sorry. Goodbye. Black. Sadiq. The cities, why they say city? Because if you live in a forest, there's nobody there. There's no Nisayon. The whole idea is he lives in Manhattan or Queens or King's Highway. And over there, he doesn't make scenes. The Gemara say, like who? Like Rav Hanina and Rav Oshaya. What's special about them? They were shoemakers, fixing shoes in a big city. Every day women bring their shoes to fix. Wasn't like today, made in China, you press few buttons and tomorrow Amazon Prime. It's by the door. $50, brand new shoes. It was a different world back then. You wear the same shoes 40 years. And not one time they raised their face to look at the women. Give me the shoes, take, no problem, come tomorrow, I'll fix it. I said, I'm very impressed that they watch their eyes completely, obviously. That's what the Gemara tried to say. But I'm impressed with something else. There's one thing that I'm just as much as impressed. That you can be the biggest rabbi in the world, instead of driving in a Mercedes or helicopter and your shamash is holding your hands and your books, you sit in a shuk and fix shoes. The biggest rabbi in the world. Imagine Rav Ovadia Yosef sitting in shuk Machane Yehuda fixing shoes. What would happen in Israel? Every one of the chachamim, one walk in the field, one walks in shoes. Hard to believe. They did not want to live from anybody's favors. Let me walk 2 hours a day, make enough to eat, and go right away and learn 20 hours to every day. They don't look at the women. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu starts his news announcement with them. Rabbi Hanina v'Rav Hoshaya, they're still innocent, meaning perfect. The second kind of people, Ani ha-machzir avedah le-be'aleah. A poor person that found a big diamond ring, 5 carat, enough to live 2 years. He barely has what to eat. Every day come back people, give me $2, $3, finally I got bread. Ah, a relief for 5 years from my stress and my agony. I found it. He runs, they told him, oh, that belongs to that billionaire. Ah, what does he care? He has hundreds like them. Big deal now, so let me keep it for myself. He won't even care. He runs, Mr. X, I found your diamond ring. And he gives it back. To return a lost object is an obligation from the Torah. If you're not doing it, it's like eating chazir. We're not going to eat chazir. We're not going to break Shabbat. So what's the big deal that he returns? No. When you're rich and you return a diamond, okay. When you barely have what to eat, a poor person that his children cry at home from starvation, and you run and you give it back to the rich person that lives in a mansion, and barely say thank you to you, thank you, shkoyach, shkoyach. And you go back, didn't give you $5 for your time. That's a very big test. And the third one, a rich person that gives miser hiddenly. Not in big noise. Nobody knows. Everything undercover. Don't put my name. Don't put my name over here. Don't put my name on the board. Don't announce. I will sponsor the lecture, but please don't say my name. Not only that. Sometimes he does, and you don't even know. Like he puts money in your under your door, and you don't know from whom. It can be for years. One guy in yeshiva more than 20 years was putting coffee and sugar and cups for 20 years. There was no cameras back then. Everyone was asking, who puts tea and coffee and for 20 years? Not me, not me. Nobody knows until they call him. Coming in the middle of the night, bringing. Now imagine how many students from that yeshiva were drinking coffee thanks to him and spitting at him. Oof, you nudnik, come, why you fighting with him. While you're drinking his coffee, you fight with him. He doesn't want to tell you. He won't tell you, hey, you're drinking from me for 20 years and this is how you're talking to me? Not a word. Because he does it 100% for the sake of heaven. Now the Gemara asks, when a person gives tzedakah in a public, he gets a lot of honor from the people. People respect him. It helps the business. It helps him in the shul, he gets a better seat, he gets aliyot. People that wanted to sue him, they think twice, how can I sue such a generous guy that helps the community? It gives him a lot of benefits. His children get the best shiduchin usually. It comes with a reward in this world. The Rashba says, כבוד ודאי יש. ומי אינו יודע לצטט דברי הרשב"א שמפרסמים עושה מצווה. הרשב"א say, it's no problem to publish the generous people that give. Why? Why? Because all the other people that hear about it get encouraged also to do. He's helping the yeshiva. Oh, you know what? I'm also going to help. That's, by the way, we're very lucky that they sell the aliyot in Yom Kippur. Imagine if they say anyone wants to make to buy aliyah in Yom Kippur have to put a bid anonymously, meaning only the gabbai would know. No one in the shul would know. How much would be the aliyah? Pa'amayim chai, 52, 101, zakha, maftir yona. Now when there's 500 people in the shul, 25,000. We finished with a joke. One guy came to a place, he said to the gabbai, I want to raise money, do you mind? He said, ah, you know what, believe me, the people here are stingy, like crazy, you're gonna waste your time. Why do you care? Let me try. So, Rabotai, I have this kamea, amulet. Anyone who will donate generously, I'll give it to you. So one person say, hi. Another person say, pa'amayim chai. 52, 60, 72, 80. The guy thinking, this gabbai didn't want me to collect money over here. Look, they're nice, they're already 80. Let's keep going. Then one guy say, $1. That was all 80 cents, 70 cents. The gabbai told me, I told you. Next time I should listen to you, not suspect you. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen. We're gonna give time. Please, any questions you have, we're going to be sitting here with your permission and answer some questions, and then Bezrat Hashem will do our vit right after.
תודה רבה לכבוד הרבנים החשובים. אנחנו מקווים שעוד יהיו הרבה ערבים כאלה. תודה רבה לאלה שנגרנו בעילום שם. שרם יהיה מן השמיים. I request the young adult, please do big favor, mitzvah. All gold chair, take downstairs to the yeshiva. When you go downstairs, right side, okay? Because tomorrow morning coming for Shacharit, אז שלא יגידו פה בלגן, תודה, זה כל המצוות. בכבוד כבוד הרב.
Thank you for הרזק וברוך. Any questions, please? Those who leave, please quietly. Any questions?
כן, גם בשבת.
Yes. When you have two hats? When you drive, you're busy driving, not looking around. You have to stay on highways. Once you're going into the street, you have a serious problem. Any more questions? I know it's after 3 hours, but please go ahead. Yes. Yeah. Very good question. I repeat the question. The lady here is trying to find out where did I get my statement that children that has birth defect, it comes from sins that they made in their previous life, right? That's the question? Okay. When we give lectures, when rabbis give lectures, rabbis that are not afraid to say the truth, because today rabbis are trying to be very careful, they're very politically correct, because they're afraid what people's reaction would be. But I made myself a rule from day one to speak the truth regardless of what people think about it. That's the truth of Hashem, that's the truth of the books, that's what I teach. It never comes to me what to teach to gain money or kavod or people popularity. That's not the way, the direction I ever went with. That's why by me you hear a lot of statements that get some people angry. The anger comes from lack of knowledge. If they only read the books I read, they would understand it perfectly. By the way, it was already proven scientifically, but before we get into that, first I answer it from the books. We have principles in Judaism. The 13 principles of Judaism. One of them is that HaKadosh Baruch Hu punish the wicked people and reward the righteous people. Yishalem sachar latzadikim u'ma'anish l'reshaim. Second principle in Judaism, as the Gemara says, en isurim belo avon. There is no suffering unless there was a sin prior to it. Hashem is not sadistic, sitting and enjoying to torture people. If someone suffers, losing money, sick, accident, all kinds of things like that, that's as a result of a previous sin. A third principle in Judaism, that we are all in reincarnations here. None of us here is for the first time. We were here in different bodies. The books are full of examples, like Moshe Rabbeinu is Hevel, and Yitro is Cain, and Tzipora is the gift that Cain had to give Hevel for killing him in past life, and thousands of examples. And the Torah say that we are here to fix what we damaged in our previous life. The source for it is in the most important Kabbalist in history, the Ari HaKadosh, in his legendary book, Shaar HaGilgulim. You can find it over there. He shows what sins cause a person to come back in reincarnation in animals, in raw material, in plants and fruits and vegetables, and sometimes in different forms of people. For instance, people that have the brain is not functioning, what Gemara called them shotim. Shotim means they cannot tell the difference between good or bad. If you give them a staff of cash, they're gonna give it out. They're not understanding, so they give it out. Today, we call it Down syndrome or autistic or different kinds of names, but we know what the Gemara is talking about. Now, since the principle is that nobody ever suffered unless he committed a sin first. And the other principle, which I did not mention yet, is that all the punishments of Hashem is measure for measure. There is no random punishment. If a person stole $100, he's gonna get a damage of $200, because that's the punishment of a thief in the Torah. You stole, you will lose money. You insult a person, someone will insult you. You kill someone, someone will kill you. That's how it goes. And it's written in Pirkei Avot that the president of the Sanhedrin, Hillel HaZaken, he saw a skeleton on water, and he said to the skeleton, someone killed you because you killed someone. And the one that killed you will be killed by someone. That's the principle of life. Everything that happens to us, it's as a result of what we did. Now, when a kid is born, we all know that we are not responsible for our sins until we become bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah. So if a baby is 2 years old and is blind, or a baby is Down syndrome, or he has all kinds of other birth defects, and we all know he did not make any sin in this life. He never made a sin because he was just born. He doesn't even know to tell the difference between good and bad. He was just born. Why one baby is born blind and the other one is born regular, or one born with brain damage and the other one doesn't have it? The answer to that is because of sins for past life. It's not random. Hashem does not make mistakes. It's not made in China. It's made in heaven. Made in China, there are mistakes. Made in heaven, there's no mistakes. So if a baby is born blind, there is a reason for it. Now remember what I said before. The Chachamim teaching us that everything that happened to us is midah keneged midah. I have a whole lecture, 2.5 hours, or I maybe show 20 different examples from the Tanakh, how everyone got exactly what they deserve based on their sins. For instance, Samson was a prophet, holy from birth. Holy from birth. The Ari HaKadosh explained, Samson is reincarnation of Nadav, the son of Aaron. Nadav and Avihu died because they did not want to get married. They looked down at the Jewish girls. He died single. The Ari HaKadosh say, Vahi Shimshon Badan. Badan, it's Nadav. If you play with the order of the letters, it's hinting that this Samson is reincarnation of Nadav, the son of Aaron. And what was his punishment? He fell in love with a non-Jewish girl, Delilah, and she destroyed him. And because in his past life he made fun of Jewish girls, in this life, who buried him? A non-Jewish girl. Because you put down my daughters, I'm gonna put you in the hand of this Goya. But the Gemara say, why from all the punishments in the world, the Philistines poked his eyes? Why they didn't cut his hands? Why they didn't cut his legs? Why they didn't burn him? Why they poked his eyes? The Gemara say, the eyes that look at this beautiful Goya, and you're not supposed to look at her and enjoy from her beauty, and the eyes follow the sins after this Goya, those are the eyes that must get punished. Not the ears, the eyes. Because it's all in the organs where you committed the sins with. So now, it's very simple, it's simple math. Nobody gets a punishment unless he committed a sin. Kids don't commit sins. If they come to the world with a punishment, it's from past life. What kind of punishments they have shows in what organs in their past life they made the sin. And if you're still not convinced, I put in my Facebook page a film, a video, 5 minutes video, of a twins that were born in Israel, girl and a guy. The girl is perfectly normal. Her brother, autistic. They're born together, and now the girl is speaking in some kind of a seminar, and she say how her autistic brother made the entire family religious. And how they connected the brother to a computer keyboard. They bring his hand to the keyboard, and they ask him, and you can see it on the video. You know, autistic kids, they're not exactly actors in Broadway. They don't know how to fake and to pretend. So they ask him, why did you come to the world like this? So he started to type, I did things in my past life that got Hashem very upset, and as a result of that, he sent me to the world like this. They ask him, what exactly did you do that Hashem sent you to the world like this? And he typed, I spoke things that I was not supposed to speak. They ask him again, what exactly did you speak? He said, I spoke Lashon Hara about people, and that's my tikkun. This is the way of me fixing my past life sins. Right in front of your eyes, an autistic person that doesn't know how to put a show. Why am I autistic? One reason, I destroyed people with my mouth. Today it's keyboard and internet and comments and all kinds of fake identity, and we destroyed people's life. So in our next life, if we will have a chance to come back, we will have to pay for what we did in our past life, and it's going to be 100% measure for measure. You understand? So I gave you now 5 sources, put them all together. I think it's pretty clear. Yes?
I have a question about that. What do you feel about any vessels to teach us to follow Hashem and teach us patience?
Who?
First
of all, I said many times in my lecture, they are the most righteous people in the world. Some of the big rabbis who used to stand when they come into the room. They are people that already fix 99%. They have very little to fix and they go to heaven. I went to speak to an autistic kid 20 years ago in Borough Park, a son of a big rabbi. He was 12 years old back then. I told him, he said to me, I suffer 1,000 tortures every minute. I told him, I feel very bad for you. He said to me, don't feel bad for me. Feel bad for yourself. I am very close to my final correction. You people have a long way to go. That was his answer to me. Meaning, I have not that much to fix. I'm almost there. I just have to fix Lashon Hara. This is all righteous people that have 1 or 2 things to fix, meaning sins they made with their mouth and their ears. That's why they're mute and deaf and they cannot communicate with speech, because it's all mida keneged mida. There's no random punishments by Hashem.
How do you feel about how much you can pay people that have special disorders?
I never offended anyone. People chose to be offended. I taught them what's the reality. You understand? If people chose to be offended by that, that's their problem, not mine. I never said something that I made up. I only said what the Torah teach. Unfortunately, most people have no idea what the Torah teach. So some of the things that they hear in lecture sound strange to them. But if they were intelligent enough, they would know that the problem is by them, not by the speaker. Because the speaker learned many, many years, and he come and he teach in something that he's a specialist in. Just like I won't debate a big doctor about a brain surgery because I know that I don't know anything that what he knows. If I will criticize him and get upset from him telling me things about the brain, that shows that I'm not so intelligent. An intelligent person knows his limitation. When people hear a speaker say something that they don't like or don't understand, the right way to approach the problem is to send him an email privately without murdering him online and all kinds of things that people do. And many people, by the way, did it. I'm upset or I'm offended from what I just heard. Can you please explain? Just like you ask me now. And I gave them the explanation. I could say that in 80 to 90% of the time, people get the point and they apologize. But some people have high ego. And they want to choose to be offended for the rest of their life. There's nothing you can do about it. Yes?
I just have a question about mentally ill people. Like, why are they mentally ill? Like, what's the cause? And what is the purpose?
That's one of the hardest mysteries in life. Mental issues, some of them we don't know the answer for, but some of them we know that comes from sins. When people make a lot of sins, when they look at things they're not supposed to look, when they eat certain things, when they behave in certain things, it can cause a person to have, Hashem Yirachem, mental issues. For instance, some of the anxiety attack, panic attack, all kinds of things that happen to people can come either from a way of life that is totally against the Torah, lack of confidence, no emunah in Hashem, living with fear constantly until the mentality of a person breaks down, has a nervous breakdown. Why? Because he was never attached. Also, his soul is very impure. People that they eat whatever they see, they make a lot of sins, they don't keep any mitzvah of the Torah. Constantly, they have on them marash chora and fear and panic and suicidal thoughts. The proof to that is that many of the people who went to big rabbis, they got them out of their depression, out of their mental issues. I made a whole series, The Psychology of the Mind and the Soul. You should listen to it. It's based on the biggest psychologist we had in Israel, which was a big rabbi, Rabbi Hoffman. Unbelievable series. It's worth billions to listen to this. Changed the life of many people. He shows psychology according to the Torah, and many of the answers that we all look for, you can find in his books. However, I admit that not all the mental diseases and phenomena that we have, we know the source for them. Not all of them. Today there are more mental issues than ever in history. It's probably because of our lifestyle, because of the way people behave and dress and eat and what you can see in the world, and the news constantly putting panic in people's head. But not everything we know, but a lot we do know. So if we address what we know, believe me, we're already going to cure a lot of people. More questions to the rabbis here. Please. Huh? Please, there are other rabbis here. Please. You can ask them, please.
But we're keeping it short. When we talk about it, we'll be here till Shacharit. I'm just going to elaborate on something that Rabbi Mizrachi said. Baruch Hashem, I have a midrasha for women in Sfat. You're all welcome, by the way. The minimum age is 40. It's for mature women. Why am I saying that? Because we learn from a certain book once a week. The book is called Sha'ar HaGilgulim, The Gates of Reincarnation, written by Rabbi Chaim Vital, the student of the Ari HaKadosh. One time I was teaching a class, and in this book, he gives a lot of sources what will affect a person in a certain way. And in many times, why will a person come back in a reincarnation? You do this sin, you'll come back in this form. You'll do that sin, you'll come back in this form. This is, in one way, one can look at it as a punishment. I look at it as that you won the lottery. Because when the Shema is standing in the heavens and it's found guilty, the neshama is begging, let me correct the sin. Don't let me lose my Gan Eden. Don't let me lose my eternity. And in some cases, the neshama, the soul, will beg, let me correct the sin. One time, I was reading one of the chapters and explaining, and it's, I just read. I don't invent things. And I read out of the text that a certain sin will cause a person to come back into this world and suffer from a disease called epilepsy. A woman in the crowd stood up and went bonkers, cursing me. How dare you? It's on video. Forget about what she cursed me that morning. She went out to the world to make a campaign, exactly like Rav Mizrachi said, on Facebook and Shmacebook, that I'm a liar and I'm a fake and slandering me left and right. Lady, what do you want from me? I just read the text and I give it out to you. I didn't invent anything. I didn't twist it to make you get upset. I did you a chesed to read it and to translate it, not to put you down, to educate you. I told her, why are you getting upset at me? I'm here to give you an answer to your problem. You have a problem? Humble yourself and understand, wait a minute, I came to this world with baggage. You think I'm here attacking you? I'm here to give you a solution. And do you think that helped? Up until today, you can find her comments on social media and the junk that she's talking about me. I don't care about that. I have a very thick skin. I'm Israeli. I can take a lot of abuse. What bothers me is the innocent people that read these comments and they believe. The reality is that many people don't want to go into the territory of Kabbalah and Hasidut and Zohar. But we have numerous books that explain to us exactly what happens in this world, exactly what the Rav was saying. I don't need to repeat, I don't want to sound like a broken record. The point to take from that nobody, I can speak to myself, about myself, nobody's here to hurt anybody. I'm not here, I do not sit at night with myself and rub my hands like that. How am I gonna hurt somebody tomorrow in my next lecture? Do you have an idea for me? I wanna hurt that person. Come on, we're not bored men. We are here, and again, I'm speaking for myself, I think they'll agree with me. I am here with a pure will to say, you know what, there's a lot of problems in this world between us. Again, and it's not about hurting anybody. I agree and disagree with what Rav Mizrachi said. Most of the mental issues is because how we live our life. You eat not kosher, don't think your mind is going to be sharp. You eat junk that crawls on the bottom of the ocean, don't think that your thoughts are going to be normal. Most of the mental illness, and I'm not making fun of anybody, I wish everybody the best, and you know, the Torah has the solutions to everybody, and exactly like Rav Mizrachi said, I've seen with my own eyes people changing their diet, changing what they're looking at, changing with the music they're listening to. Suddenly many of the mental issues pass. Now, I'm not talking about something that is born autism, mental retardation, Down syndrome, I'm not talking about that. To make a long story short, God is so merciful that he says, okay, you messed up. I'll give you the option to correct. And you know what? In most cases, the soul says, please help me. And Hashem says, where do you want to go? Do you want to correct this problem? Choose where you want to go. You can go to this family, to this family, to that family. The reality is that the fact that we are here in this world is a zchut, it's a chesed, it's a present that Hashem allows us to correct my problems. Now, if I let my ego lead me, I will never do a tikkun. That's the problem with most people, because their ego doesn't allow them to do a tikkun, a rectification to their soul. If you're smart, humble yourself, accept the slap that you're getting from the face. The person who's slapping you is helping you. In some cases, of course, I'm not talking about somebody's coming now to degrade you. I'm talking about a learned individual, a rabbi. The slaps that you, and again, I can only speak for myself, but I think the rabbis will agree with me. The slaps that you're getting from us, these are, wake up. Here, I'm giving you a solution to your problem. Not you, but other people. The reality is that the holy books
tell us exactly what's going on in this world. Many people don't want to get into this territory. I was now invited to a certain community. They told me, don't talk about the Zohar. Don't talk about Kabbalah. Just give us basic things. Don't talk about Kabbalah. Okay, no problem. I'll tell you the same thing with the different words. I'm not going to say the Zohar said. I said our sages will say. You still get the same thing. The point is that a lot of people don't want to hear the truth. Why? Because in our generation, just give me a pill. Give me a pill. Let me swallow something of deception. I don't want to work hard. I don't want it to hurt. I don't want to face my own reality. I don't want to look in the mirror and say, I am bad. I am wrong. I have sinned. Give me a pill. Do you have a pill? You know, when people tell me, listen, I have this problem. I tell them, do this mitzvah. Give me something else. What do you think? It's an auction? Not too long ago, a lady in a lecture told me, I have a serious problem with parnasa. Can you give me a bracha? I told her, why don't you sit every day and say Birkat Amazon? No, it's too long. Do you have something else? Anything, what do you think? I'm Krusty the Clown. I'm going to pull something out of my pocket here, something you don't like what I told you. So the reality is that the holy books tell us exactly how to reach a tikkun. Most people don't want to deal with it. I don't want to deal with the fact that really, once I did something bad, I have sinned. Me, the symbol of perfection, yeah, you sinned. Say thank you to the Kadosh Baruch Hu is even letting you come down to this world and correct what you did. So I don't think neither one of us here is here to offend anybody, to hurt anybody. And yes, this lady in the class up until today, and how many times I tried to appease her and to make her calm down, she's still angry and she's still attacking me. She's still slandering me, and I keep telling her, Giveret, lady, I have the cure to your problem. So until you're going to continue slandering me, you're not going to have a cure. Why do you think you came into the world? To do a tikkun. So I don't think anybody of us here is trying to hurt anybody, not to make fun of anybody. Everybody has problems. I can definitely strengthen that the reality is that the majority of mental illnesses and emotional illnesses is from what we eat, what we see, what we listen, how we talk, how we behave. A person lives a certain lifestyle. So, yeah, it's going to affect you. The Ari HaKadosh, the Holy Arizal, Rabbi Yitzchak Luria, says that you eat certain things that are not kosher, it will cause timtum asechel. Timtum asechel is that your mind is not balanced. So it will cause anxieties and fears and depression and all sorts of different side effects. Now, will a pill help? I didn't see one pill that helped up to now. The whole pill industry failed. Why? Because it doesn't cure. You know what it does? It numbs. Everybody's numb. You go to schools, all the kids are numb. Why are you numb? Because they just got a dose of something, whatever it is. The pills don't help. Hard work helps. Getting the truth slammed into your face, yeah, nobody wants to hear the truth. But that's help. So a lot of people do not want to hear the truth. So unfortunately, there are not enough people that will come out and tell you, that's the truth, what are you willing to do about it? And I know I'm looking at you, but it's for everybody. I mean, I'm looking at you because you asked the question.
I just want to make a comment. In my line of work, if you don't have enemies, you're not doing the right thing.
So I can't hear you. It's not only now in your line of work, it's everybody.
It's in the whole world.
Yeah? Yeah? The bottom line is that the fact that you are sitting here, if you are wise enough, I'm turning to everybody, not to you. If you're wise enough or humble enough to humble yourself, to understand what you did wrong, you'll be able to correct yourself. And if you're ignorant, then you'll never correct yourself. And you'll come back here again and again and again. The problem is that there's no more chances. That's it, Mashiach is coming. This is the last chance. I'll tell you one thing before we take other questions. Two things. We don't know how ridiculous we look. That's why we have mirrors. I'll tell you two stories. One story is that one time I gave a class, and the next day I looked at the video, and what do you know? I looked like Gargamel. You know Gargamel? The what do you call him? The Mechashef, the sorcerer of the Smurfs. Why? Because one of my antennas were like this. That's how I looked. Okay? And I'm looking at the video. Oh my gosh. And I look like Gargamel, one static. It's pulled out. And my kids, and I tell the editor, why did you put it online? Take it off. He's like, you can't take it off. You know how many places the video is on, the links and the sharing and the... And I'm like, look at that. What is that? Is that the number? Is that 7,000 views? 7,000 people looked at me like that. But you know what? I was like, you know what? 7,000 people had a good laugh. No, la briot. They had laughter on my account. Sababa. It's okay. The next day I go to the class and I tell the ladies, why couldn't you go like that? You couldn't tell me you look like an idiot. Tuck your pe'ah back behind your ear. You couldn't say that. 40 women are sitting there. You couldn't just go like this. So I depend on other people to show me how ridiculous I look. Now, if I will tell you how ridiculous you look, you're going to slap me across my face. Unless you're smart and you say, thank you so much for making me look normal. Next story. A certain individual that works for our organization for many, many years, we consider this individual a friend, a follower, the individual calls me the rabbi and so forth. One time, the person came and told me something that I don't do so nice, something not so appropriate. Now, on the outside, it looked like that. On the inside, a volcano of anger. How dare she say this to me? Me! And inside, an earthquake. Outside, for 5 hours, I had steam coming out of my ears, out of my nose. I was so upset, I couldn't do anything. And at some point, I told myself, why are you upset? Let's analyze now why you are upset, Mr. Anava. And I sat with myself and I said, you know, I'm upset. Because she's right. That person came and pointed out, you know what courage it is to come and say, you do this act. So instead of getting upset, I called her up and said, thank you so much. I so appreciate what you told me. Because nobody had the nerve to come and tell me, by the way, this is what you're doing. Doesn't look so good. En Adam ro'et nigei atzmo. A person cannot see his own afflictions. I depend on you. I depend on you telling me your hair is sticking out. You have breakfast in the beard. You know, on Shabbat, I was giving a lecture somewhere. I sat on a chair and I sat on somebody's meal. So when I got up, the meal was on my back. Now you think I saw that? Somebody told me, you have lettuce on your back. I don't know what. Now most people didn't see it. Hey, Musha comes up to the rabbi and he just gave a speech. Oh, I'm going to tell him that he has lettuce and tomatoes on his tuchus. So I depend on the courtesy of other people to come and tell me, you look like a clown. Now what would my ego tell me? Lech mipo, go away from here. How dare you talk to me like this? You know who I am? So my hero is Moshe Rabbeinu. You know, it's very mind-boggling. Why do you call him Moshe Rabbeinu? You know he should be called Moshe Hanavi. Lo kam ki Navi b'Yisrael. Why Shmuel is called Shmuel Hanavi? Called Moshe Hanavi. He's the Navi. Why don't you call him Moshe HaMelech? We call David HaMelech. Should be called Moshe HaMelech. He was a king. How do you call him? Rabbeinu. Why? Because he's our teacher. You know, now when you walk in the street with a beard, everybody's Rabbeinu. This is not the Rabbeinu. Moshe is the only Rabbeinu. Look at his life. Look at his behavior. We just read Parashat Noach, Parashat Korach. Korach comes and argues with him. Now, Korach was not some shmo from the neighborhood. Korach was a powerful, rich politician, Talmid Chacham, everything. A cousin. And he goes and rebukes Moshe Rabbeinu. You would think that Moshe Rabbeinu will cut his head off. Right away, flick his finger, cut his head off. Moed b'malchut, goes against the king. What does the Torah tell us? Vayipol al panav, vayevk. He fell on his face and he started crying. Moshe Rabbeinu says, maybe Korach is right. Maybe I did something. So the reality is that we're all born in this world, I'm going to say a harsh word, don't get offended, with defects. If you're humble, you fix it. If you're arrogant, you will go out of the world with greater defects. Then you're going to come back here again. It doesn't mean that you're bad. It means that I blemish something, Hashem gives you an opportunity to fix, and it will come in millions of ways. And yes, we have holy books that will come and say, you do this sin, this is what's going to happen. You do this sin, this is how you're going to come back here. Kadosh Baruch Hu created the world with rules, with a set of rules, and that's it. You can't digest the rules. The point is to be humble and to understand that I came here to the world to reach my tikkun. If I don't reach my tikkun, I come here in a rerun, and another rerun, and if I don't do my tikkun, by the way, life is hard. A smart person, he accepts the emet, the truth, and how do I change that and apply that? And I think I speak for the name of the three of us. Nobody's here trying to hurt anybody. If I come and tell a person, this is the situation, and I had thousands of cases, the people came and told me, that's the problem. I told them, that's the cause. And they got upset at me. Why are you telling me that? Because that's the cause. A woman came to me not too long ago with a certain issue. I was debating how to give her the slap, like this or like that. So I just told her, you don't cover your hair. Ah! What kind of a rabbi are you? I said, the rabbi, they will tell you what's the solution to your problem. The emet hurts, truth hurts. But if you're smart, then the truth makes you go out of this world with flying stars. That's what you need to focus on. And again, I don't think any rabbi that talks the truth is here with an agenda to hurt anybody. I did not fly 7,000 miles from Eretz Israel to offend you. I have enough work to do. And I don't think Yaron Reuven flew 1,800 miles to Florida to offend anybody. He came here to inspire, to teach. Why? I know it sounds like a cliche. We saw the light. Now I want you to see the light. I feel bad. I look at people, I feel real bad for them. Why don't you get it, Habibi? Do tshuva already. Get your act together. Every day is valuable. People take them like to crank an engine. 40 years. No, start already. What are you waiting for? So I feel like the luckiest man in the world, because the Kadosh Baruch Hu not only opened my eyes, but allowed me and still allows me to do tshuva. You know that most people, when they do an act, a mitzvah, they say bracha, asher kidashanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu laneach tefillin. Very nice of you. You know what I say before I do a mitzvah? I remove away any attention. I say, Hashem, toda, Hashem, toda, that you allowed me to now put tefillin on. Toda, that you allowed me to say birkat hamazon, because most people run to the pizzeria where it's mezonot. Say the birkat hamazon. I thank the Kadosh Baruch Hu. You know how many men call me? Can I still put tefillin on? It's 4:45. Yeah, you still have a few more minutes. It's not shkiah yet. I thank Hashem, Baruch Hashem, that you didn't activate the Yetzer Hara today, here or here or here. Be appreciative that Kadosh Baruch Hu even included you, and you gotta start the engine faster. I feel bad when I look at people and another problem and another headache and another challenge and another failure, and they don't get it. Get your act together, your days are numbered in this world. So again, to conclude at least this question and take many other questions, I speak for myself, and I'm sure for the other rabbis, nobody's here to hurt anybody. Maybe some people, yes, that's why I'm speaking for myself. The truth is the only way to correct yourself. And yes, I wasn't here, I had to run out for a second to the bathroom. I didn't hear exactly what Rabbi Mizrachi said. No, in regards to the autism and the kids and special needs, all the kindness of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And yes, there are so many books, just people don't like reading the books. Or worse than that, they don't know how to read the book. So they read the book and they understand it however they want to. Either they don't know Hebrew, either they don't know Aramaic, either they don't like what the person says in the book. Like this woman who, up until today, slanders me all over the place. I wanted to tell her, why don't you go down the hill, I live in Tzfat, go down the hill to the grave of the Arizal, complain over there, write a comment on his grave. Why are you writing a comment on my Facebook? He wrote the book. I just read the book and I tell you. The Torah has the answers for everything. A smart person looks in the Torah, finds all the answers to all your problems.
Next question. Well, you want to see me answer the question or you want a new question?
New question.
New question. Covered. Everything is long. You have three speakers that speak an average of 3 hours a lecture.
And then take a breath and speak another 3 hours.
Boteach.
Basically, you know, from all the mitzvot or things that we're not supposed to be doing, why is homosexuality such a big deal for this person not keeping Shabbat?
Oh.
So, I was hoping that you can...
Okay, so... Shmuli Boteach, Shem Reshaim Yerkav, just to emphasize in my previous video, is a person that's a machtia rabin. And not only that, he's a machtia rabim on a regular basis in the biggest public forum there is. He writes books with people that are enemies of Hashem. Like, for example, this pornography star, Pamela Anderson, or he writes books in a way to manipulate the Torah, like kosher Jesus, making Avodah Zarah as if it sounds kosher, as if you could kosher the pig. So he's been doing this for over 2 decades. And the Torah says, Ayotze mi tameh tameh. Someone that's tameh, someone that's impure, all that he produces is impure. Unfortunately, recent news came out that his daughter opened a sex shop in Tel Aviv, and she called it kosher sex. Okay, this is what's the name of the store in Tel Aviv. And she goes on the news. She goes, they asked her, wait, you're a rabbi's daughter. Aren't you worried that the public is going to be against you? She goes, no, I already got the rabbi's approval. He said, which rabbi? He goes, my father. That's what she said in a TV interview. In a book. So now, HaKadosh Baruch Hu has 613 mitzvot. The rabbis have 7 mitzvot. Believe it or not, most people think it's the opposite. They think 613 the rabbis, the 7 Hashem. No, it's 613 mitzvot Hashem, 7 the rabbis. Now, when it comes to the din of homosexuality, HaKadosh Baruch Hu calls it Toivat Hashem. He calls it, I see it as disgusting. How disgusting? Sometimes you see an animal while you're driving, especially us three, sometimes we drive 2-3 o'clock in the morning to go home. And sometimes by the time you saw the animal, you already ran it over. It's too late. Now the next day, people are going to walk by that animal, and its liver is going to be here, its lungs are all going to be here, the teeth are going to be here, all over the place. And the stench that's going to come out of it after 8-9 hours of being in heat is disgusting. So when you walk by it, you're going to say, this is disgusting. Call some department, get this disgusting animal out of here. That's what Toivat Hashem means. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu sees the act of homosexuality, he says, that's disgusting. How disgusting? Now, normal human beings find bestiality as disgusting. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says this, and homosexuality, same thing to me. So when a so-called rabbi of America, self-proclaimed rabbi of America, decides to say that homosexuality, that's no big deal. There's 613 mitzvot, so you don't do one. This is disgusting. And it's our obligation as Jews, not speakers, as Jews, to fulfill the mitzvah of limchot et Amalek, to destroy Amalek. Amalek is not a person, per se. Amalek is safek, is a doubt. Is a doubt. So I had Amalek show up to my lecture last night, Baruch Hashem. Gave me the mitzvah. Why? I was able to go against Amalek and destroy him until he ran out. Until he ran out. Why? Because what Amalek does is not that he tells you, listen, you should drive on Shabbat. No, he doesn't say that. Amalek doesn't say that. Amalek says, maybe the driving is not allowed, but playing on the phone is rabbinical. It's rabbinical, so maybe that's allowed. Maybe the rabbis are really saying this because of any starts manipulating the Torah in such a way that he puts a doubt in your mind on the mitzvot that you're doing. And that's what Boteach Shem Reshaim Merkav is doing, and as in the name of a rabbi. If he was some goy, if he was some Buddhist saying that homosexuality is the same, we wouldn't pay attention to him. But because he's doing it in the name of the Torah, and he's saying that this is not a big deal, this mitzvah. So you have 612 other mitzvot you can do. In essence, what you did is you could pretty much give the permission to the English-speaking public to just pick and choose which mitzvah you don't think is a big deal so you can make an avira here. You could just decide, oh, that's why Boteach says this one's not good. Well, this one is not relevant to me, but Shabbat is relevant. Okay, wait, so Shabbat is not relevant? Okay, so stealing, so murder, so this, so that. In essence, you just destroy the entire Torah. So that's why it's our obligation as Jews to fight against it. The fact that many people don't, that's nothing to say. I have an obligation. Rabbi Mizrachi has an obligation. Rabbi Anava has an obligation. You have an obligation. That's it. Anyone that wants to fulfill the obligation is simply rewarded for it. Anyone that doesn't, Hashem finds something else. And that's what I'll finish with and go to the next question. It's not that we have a merit and that we're great and we're special or you're special. No. The only thing that we have is free choice to choose whether we are going to be the vessel that Hashem does whatever he wants anyway. Hashem is going to run the world with or without us. He's perfect. Anyone that tells you otherwise, kofel. Hashem is going to bring point A to point B regardless, whether I exist or I don't exist. The only choice I have is whether I choose for Hashem to be the vessel that he's going to be, use me as the donkey to bring the message to Bilam. Alvay, I could be a donkey. Why? Donkey's in the Torah, I'm not in Torah. I want to be a donkey. Why? Because a donkey, vayiftach Hashem et piyaton. So alvay, Hashem opens my mouth and gives you the message. That's what my choice is. You have the same choice. The point is, Rabotai, everybody has the same choice. Are you going to be the messenger? You're going to be the mailman that delivers the truth? Or are you going to say, ah, somebody else is going to do it. 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 But you're not going to get the schal. So that's in essence what our job is in the world. All of us.
Okay.
Any?
Yeah. Okay, just one last question because we have to pray our vita, I was told. One final question for tonight.
You're too young for our seminary.
What?
You're too young for the seminary. The seminary?
How long?
No, the seminary has daily classes. The seminary has daily classes that the local women come and enjoy everyday classes.
Right.
There are women who come for a month, for 3 months, for 2 months, and there are women who come in organized groups. If they come for a week or 10 days, that's usually every 2 months as a group. And the group is private. Excuse me?
If I go, I choose.
Yes, some ladies come and they rent an Airbnb for 3 months and they come to classes whenever they want, however they want, they build their own schedule. But the seminary is built for mature women that, you know, today a young lady that wants to learn Torah, she goes to a seminary in Yerushalayim. If you're 28, 35, 62, you have nowhere to go.
It's fat, no?
Yeah.
It's fat.
You have nowhere to go. A lot of our students are in their 60s and 50s and 70s. We have a student, she's 79 years old. Where does a 79-year-old woman go when she wants to learn Torah? She's one of our best students. And of course, there are young ones in the 50s. So we have the exact same thing for men also. But a lot of the women, they come and they live there and they come every day to classes. Some take 2 classes a day, some take 10 classes a day. A lot of the classes are not taught by me. Now I'm gone for 2 weeks. The classes are still running. A lot of women, they come, they can't take a lot, too much time off. They come for 10 days, a week, there's organized groups. When I'm gone, there's other teachers there, there's other rabbis, there's other female teachers. The sad reality is that people come because they want me. If I'm not there, people are upset. But whatever, listen, I have an obligation also for the rest of the students.
Thank you very much, Rabotai. Thank you very much. We are going to take Kaddish now. Rabbi Hananiah ben Akashia Omer. Ratzal Kadosh Baruch Hu Nefesh.
Who's next? Who's the one who wants one TT? Hey, oh, 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 ay, 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 ay. Oh, 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 ay, 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 ay. Let's go to the rest of you. In Chayim Arukim, Shlemi, Lehi Torah, Mitzvot, Biyut Chassadim, Nachat Bayayim, 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 Bayayim,